Holy crap.
People persist in doubting the evidence.
Don't run and hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. The truth will set you free.
You're listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
We're putting all of our incarnate towards Jimmy Church on Dark Matter Radio.
And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
That's my evil pre-Halloween laugh. All right, everybody, how you doing? How you doing? It's Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today's Wednesday, September 10th. Wow, tomorrow's the 11th. 252 days into the new year. We are live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here in sunny Gates of Hell, Burbank, California for KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. Welcome, everybody listening around the world, all across the United States. Going to give you a warning right now. Tweet deck wouldn't open for me tonight. I'm going old school. I got Twitter open, and I got to refresh and scroll. Oh, do I hate life. Man alive. Big salute to the proud men and women in uniform all around the world, defending that Constitution of ours, keeping that freedom of speech live and well. That's what this show is all about. How you doing? I am great. Great show last night. Wow. Wow. Trust me on this. What happened last night happens just once in a while, and it did last night. It was amazing. Still digesting it, as so are you. I haven't gone back and listened to the audio yet. Man. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Brian. It was pretty cool. All right. See, you're wondering what I'm doing right now. I'm just settling in into the chair, making sure the coffee's in the right spot. Can't knock it over, if you know what I mean. All right. Today, not yesterday, not tomorrow, today, Aerosmith guitarist Joe Perry, 64 years old. 64. Man. I remember 10 years ago, maybe 12, Sarzo and I went down to the Honda Panda down in Anaheim. And we were invited down by the band. So we go check out Aerosmith. I forget who was opening. Oh, that band, Television or TV or whatever, the Stone Temple Pilots spinoff. But anyway, so we go down, and Rudy and I, the band, the crew for Aerosmith was basically the White Snake crew. And so we were running around. It was great. It was awesome. We had a good time. But this is the thing. Rudy and I were at the mixing console, and we watched the show from there. And I watched Steve and Joe and that band back then. That was 12 years ago. So Steve back then was probably in his early 50s. Joe was, I'm looking now, he's 64 today, so he's probably 52, 51 years old back when we did this. And I watched Steve backflip on that stage for 2.5 or 3 hours. I still have the set list somewhere. I stole it. But to think that those guys are doing it like they are today, this ain't the Stones. No, man. It's Aerosmith. Those guys are still doing it today. Joe Perry, 64 years old. Still the Shredmaster King. One of them. And today also, check this out. Director Guy Ritchie, 46. With great films like Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels. Snatch. Watch Snatch 100 times. Revolver, great flick. Rock and Rolla, Toby Kebbell. With all of that going on now, finally, nobody remembers that he was the husband, that he was the guy married to Madonna. He's finally washed his hands of that, and now he's standing on his own. Guy Ritchie, 46 years old. Follow us on Twitter, at J Church Radio, hashtag DM Radio Net. Go hang out in the sandbox. Tonight, I'm limited, man. I'm limited to the at J Church Radio feed. Oh, man, I am bummed. It just was spinning. It just wouldn't open. Rick Sinnott, you know the drill. You know what's going on. I use the external version of TweetDeck. I don't use the internal version. I've got some weird EXE DLL thing that it just, I don't know. It won't open. Bummed. Anyway, at J Church Radio, hashtag DM Radio Net. Come hang out with us. All right? Follow, like, and subscribe. You've seen the new Dark Matter Radio page. We're getting really close to with getting JimmyChurchRadio.com just slick. It's getting close. It is getting fine-tuned. And the podcast page is very close. I think it's done. Technically, it's done. If you want to check out the podcast page, go over to JimmyChurchRadio.com. It's right there, podcast. Click on that. I put a little note from the heart on the podcast page today. It's ready. The apps are done. Libsyn has said, okay, we're ready to go. So, this is my decision and only mine. But I am not going to launch the podcast on September 11th. It ain't going to happen, so forget about it for obvious reasons. So, it will be Friday. It will be up and ready and done. You can go and do it. You can go download the apps if you want. But we will be all fresh and ready with a breath mint on Friday morning. How cool is that? I hope everybody is happy. It's this was done for you. You've made the request. And I think all the apps are cool. I have approved them all myself. I think they're slick. I think they are state of the art. And nothing but the best for our Fade or Not family. Okay, so there you go. If you want to check everything out, just go over and click on podcast. It is all there. You can email throughout the show tonight. That's right. Stanton T. Friedman. And the T is there to separate him from all the other Stan Friedmans out there in the world. Stanton Friedman, Dark Matter Radio Day. Okay, he was just on Podcast UFO right before us, live. And now he will be with us this evening. And it's better us than them. If you know what I mean. Shoot me an email to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. You know the drill. Let's see here. What have we got for Stanton? 1, 2, 3. All right. That's it. Only 3 questions for Stanton tonight. Come on. Shoot me some questions for Stanton Friedman. Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. I know you can tweet him in too. Tweet seems to be the way of the world, doesn't it? It's really funny how things have changed. Email is too much work. Even for me. It's all about texting now. So funny. All right. Last night. All right. Shall I talk about it? Last night. Oh, by the way, I'll just let everybody know. Should I spoil the surprise now? All right. I've got a really cool guest at the bottom of the hour. I slipped and I put it on Facebook. I didn't tweet it out. I slipped and then I thought about bringing it back, but everybody saw it. So you know what? Okay. So we'll just let that stew for a minute. But let's just say who's on at the bottom of the hour you guys have asked for about 100 times in the last 2 weeks. So we're going to do a little drive-by with him tonight at 7:30. Okay? And then he'll be on the show next week. There's a reason why we couldn't do it tonight. He wanted to tonight, but he couldn't. We'll talk about that at the bottom of the hour. All right? It's going to be cool, too. Man. All fired up over this one. Okay, so concerning last night. Look, the bottom line with last night was this. That 17-year mystery needed to get put to bed. Okay? I had the ability to do it, and I did it, and I chose. And for Brian, J.L. Glass, to come on the show and speak very openly about how, when, why, where, what about that Area 51 caller was important. I wanted to put it to bed. I really did. And I was right in the middle, and I chose to do it that way. But it was important for everybody, that mystery. So anytime, you know, think about how many people listen to that call every single day and wonder if, well, you know what? It was put to bed. And for him, for 17 years, he's had that he was dealing with. I'm speaking about Brian directly. And he was able to do that last night. Get on the couch and talk to you, to everybody out there, and explain. I loved every minute of it. And I could tell at the end of the show, the way that he continued tweeting and hanging out with everybody here last night and the messages today, you know, that's a cleansed soul. He didn't have to do that. He's got a great career and a great life. Things are perfect for him and Michael. But no, he came on last night to speak to you about this. And that was the point. He did not intend to deceive anybody with that phone call. It was theatrics. It was supposed to be fun. How was he supposed to know that the satellites were going to go down? That Art was going to get caught by surprise? How was it? Nobody knows. Nobody knows. It was just another phone call on an open lines Area 51 night on coast to coast. That's all it was. He didn't mean anything by it. And so for 17 years holding that in, well, now we know. The Area 51 caller was Brian J.L. Glass. A guy that did not need to come forward, and he did. All right? I got a bunch of email about it. Almost all of it was cool, just so you know. This email from Ben Miller says, after the show with the Area 51 caller of old, I listened to the original call as posted on YouTube. Nearby was a posting of David Oates. Remember that guy? The speech reversal expert. Remember that guy, David Oates? Sometime later, analyzing the frantic caller's speech, at the end, Mr. Oates says he is convinced that the call was authentic. David Oates. Now that's education. Speech reversal theory may be somewhat unreliable. Yeah, think. That was from Ben Miller. Now, check this. I got a bunch of email about this today. I posted it, put it up on Facebook. I put it up on Twitter, too, as well. About this EMT blast that's headed our way from Debbie, MC Writer. This is directly from NOAA. A forecast watch for NOAA scale G2 moderate geomagnetic storm conditions has been issued for 12th of September 2014 as a result of the coronal mass ejection associated with the M4-5 flare observed on early September 9th, 2014. The arrival of the plasma cloud at Earth's magnetosphere is forecast for early on the 12th. G1 minor conditions are forecast to persist into the 13th of September 2014. Hold on to your seats. Now, we're not saying it's the end of the world. Well, we don't know. But certainly expect some interference. And please keep your sunscreen handy. I'm a little nervous about it. It's a weird thing for them to post this. We posted the photograph, the JPEG of the ejection. It's pretty scary looking, pretty intimidating. This is Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, got a little surprise for you. You're going to enjoy at the bottom of the hour, and then we'll be joined by none other than Stanton T. Friedman. His DM. RN, Dark Matter Radio Network, Day. It's a Friedman Palooza Fest here on the network. I'll be back right after this. Shoot me an email to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
You're listening to Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444, or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right, welcome back. Fade to Black. Only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Bespoke radio for the masses. Oh, yeah. So, between the start of the show and now, I just looked over 193 tweets. Now, how am I supposed to know anything? My goodness gracious. I got to do this manually. I did see a quick tweet. One of the questions that wasn't answered last night was, what were the words that triggered the satellite outage? I don't know. I don't think anybody knows. But it was that's a coinkydink right there that you just, yeah, that's just too strange. Way too strange. Email from Damien. He says, this is from yesterday. Brian Glass sounds a lot like the infamous freaked out caller from Art on Coast to Coast. Really? Next email from Damien. Disregard that last email. Apparently it is. I tuned in late. Back to that. The thing is, when that went down last night and I chose to have Brian call in and sort of recreate the moment and to see everybody's reactions, I did that consciously. I didn't do it to fool everybody. What I did do was try to show everybody that it was that guy. This wasn't a guy imitating the Area 51 caller. No. And I immediately saw what happened on Twitter last night and with email coming in. It's the guy, because we all know that voice. It's the guy. It's the guy. It's the guy. It's the Area 51 caller. It's the guy. Because when I was about to disclose that it was the guy, I wanted to make sure that everybody understood that it was the guy. We all know that voice. When I called Brian on the phone and he picked up and said, "Hello, Jimmy," I immediately knew it was the guy. And that's how I didn't even say hello. I was like, "Dude, it is you." And that's why that was done that way last night. It wasn't done to fool everybody. I just wanted everybody to know in their heart of hearts that that was the Area 51 guy. That's why. Because I didn't want him to come on and say, "Hey, I was the caller," and then everybody would say, "Oh, no, it's not. It's somebody that thinks it. Oh, come on. What proof do you have?" No. That's why we did it in reverse last night. I didn't do it to fool anybody. Because when I pulled up that fader and said, "Okay, everybody, the world, here it is. This is the Area 51 caller. His name is Brian J.L. Glass. Brian, say hi to everybody." That was the intention. That was the intention. All the phone calls that came in, and I took all of those back to back to back. I did that for the exact same reason. Because everybody knew. Everybody identified immediately. And when I said yesterday that there was probably, I don't know. I don't have the Arbitron ratings for the evening that that was done, which apparently, by the way, was, I'm going to double check the facts on this, but September 11th, 1997, Brian said that that is the anniversary. I'm going to check into that just to make double, quadruple fact check sure on that. But the ratings that night for Art, as he cruised through the 90s, the late 90s especially, you're talking 15, 20, 25 million people a night were listening to his show. I have no idea how many people were listening that night, but it was indeed in the tens of millions. So we're all familiar with that. With all of the YouTube views and everything that has occurred since 1997 with that call, we have all listened to that voice many, many times. And when the calls were coming in last night on the show, everybody identified him as that guy. And I wanted to just lay that out there for everybody. Okay? All right. Chase Brandon. I went back and listened to some more of Brandon last night, and I don't know. I'm thinking about, and I will ask Twitter to do this for me, please. Should we bring Chase on the show? Okay, should we bring him on the show? I'm a little reticent. Should we bring Chase Brandon on the show? I'll leave it up to you guys for that. You want me to bring him on the show, I will do that and have him tell the story again. I feel uncomfortable with it. Okay? I just feel deception on the part of Chase. I just don't feel that anybody with that was in the employ of the CIA for 25 years would, and wants to hold back and not talk about certain things because of his allegiance to the country and to the Constitution and to what the CIA is all about. Then he comes out and says these things. I'm a little hesitant. So you want me to bring Chase on the show? I'll bring him on the show. I'll chase him down and I will bring him on the show. All right, I'll leave it up to you guys. Okay, let's do this. Let's back up. Oh, Twitter, now everything is backwards for me. I don't even know what to do with this mess. Ed Dames? No. Look at this. MC Ryder. Yeah, you know, by the way, not only MC, but I got a bunch of emails on this solar stuff, and it's kind of strange how it's not why, I don't know. Everybody wants to, when it comes to the mainstream media, just scare the crap out of everybody all the time. And the one thing that would scare the crap out of everybody, they're not reporting on. Rick Sennett just said the sandbox will rip him apart. Yeah. You know, I'm just saying when it comes to something like this, man, you know, we're talking about Chase Brandon. There's just something there. I don't know. Maybe it's the nice teeth and the perfect beard and the nice coif. I don't know. There's something about Chase Brandon that just makes me uncomfortable. Guest request. Angel. Michelangelo. Angel. Michael Anderson. Angel Espino on the show. I'll have Angel on anytime he wants to come on. He knows that. I certainly interrupt him every chance I get. I don't know if he's listening now, but after this next guest, Angel wants to call in. He can call in anytime. Angel's cool. Anybody that calls himself the Jackal. The Jackal. Yeah, I'll have Angel on. That's a good idea. Yeah, I'll do Angel. Huh. Should we do it tomorrow night? That's call-in night. Should we do an actual Angel, like, two-hour night? I'm down for that. Would Angel? Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. Nothing wrong with that. Angel's cool. All right, let's see. Roswell Proof at CIA Spring Cleaning. That's exactly my point. Betty Oliver kick his ass to the curb. we know who Angel is. Absolutely. All right. I think I'm about ready. Angel, if you're listening, get a hold of me, man. Let's do something in the next, we'll do it Monday. We'll do it Tuesday. All right. With that, I think we're about ready. This is Fade to Black. I'm excited. Got a really cool surprise for you at the bottom. All right. Okay, I'm ready. I'm ready on this end. Let's do this. Shoot me an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. You can come in and join us in the sandbox at J Church Radio. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter.
You're listening to Fade to Black
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
That might be my favorite track on this show, right there. It's just not right that a guy can play guitar like that. It's just not fair. All right, this is Fade to Black. only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm waiting for our special caller to call in. We got about 30 seconds. I did want to say this about Stanton. Over the last couple of weeks, reaching out, talking to him, and the special thanks and everything and that everybody did here, tweeting back and forth with Stanton was great. And so I wanted to take the opportunity tonight, everybody here at Dark Matter, bring him on and just hear from the man himself. It is very, very critical for all of ufology to hang on. Here's our caller. Are you guys ready for this? I'm just going to be nice and gentle, and I'm going to throw a softball out there for everybody. Nice surprise call from Mr. Phil Hendrie. Phil, how are you tonight, sir?
Great. Wow, that was interesting. I was just calling, and there I am.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Because...
That's cool.
But, you know, I didn't know if you were going to be drop on the bottom of the hour. You're a professional, of course. And you're right there on time. So, you know what?
Thank you, yeah.
Yeah, we're both caught with our pants down. So, there you go. So, hey, Phil, let me just...
Well, I wouldn't say my pants are down, necessarily. I'd say I'm just waking up here. But I'm very happy to be with you, Jimmy, and thanks for having me on.
Hey, absolutely. But, you know, Phil, sure. I'm a little mad at you. Because here you are tomorrow night. The thing is this, we all wonder what goes on behind the curtain. You know, how does this stuff get done? And here you are live tomorrow night down in Irvine when I am broadcasting. So I can't go. I've been wanting to see this forever. Yeah. And yeah, I'm a little angry. I'm a little ticked off.
You should have been angry at me on the 30th of July and the 5th of June because I did the exact same thing.
That's what.
But I know it's like, brother. It's being on the radio means you are working when all the cool stuff happens, like Thanksgiving, Christmas, you know, on and on. So that is our plight. Yeah,
it is our plight. And I do this show. You know, we're live every night, right in prime time, 7 to 10, when all of the cool stuff is going on here in LA. I'm forced into missing it all. And it's funny, all of my friends, hey, Jimmy, so listen, tomorrow night, you know, after the show, you want to come down and hang out with it? I can't, you know, I'm stuck.
Yeah.
I'm stuck.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's the way it is.
Tell me.
When I first started out, not to interrupt you, but I got off the air at midnight. Actually, my second gig in radio was off the air at midnight. So it always seemed like every time I had a date with my girlfriend, it was at least at midnight or 12:30 when I'd meet her to go dancing, to have a drink or whatever. So, you know, we spent the first year of our relationship after midnight. Everything was done, pretty much in the wee hours.
Yeah, you had to go to, like, Mel's Drive-In or Denny's.
Everything. Yeah. Oh, Denny's, definitely. Yeah.
I used to, this is the thing, I used to catch you early on in the mid-90s on Extra Sports 690 out of San Diego, I believe. And I would
in the mid-90s, I was out in Miami, but a lot of people make that mistake. I mean, between 90 and 96, I was in Atlanta, Minneapolis, and Miami. And then in 96, I came to Los Angeles. So you're close. Yeah. Well,
okay.
Like 97.
Okay. 97. And I would roll up. And the thing is I could catch you from San Diego all the way to where I lived in Sherman Oaks. And I would listen and listen. I'm like, in the very, very beginning, just like everybody else, you know, when you catch your first show for the first time, I should say. And I'm like, man, what is going on here? What is going on?
Yeah.
And you had me. You had me hook, line, and sinker. Where did the idea come from?
Not getting any phone calls, basically, you know. And I always did character voices, and I always liked the kind of humor that I like is humor that's really, you know, that is as close to reality as you can get it. So I literally, not kidding, I was working in Ventura at a little small station in the in late 1990, and literally wasn't getting any phone calls. So I, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine. He said, why don't you just make the calls up yourself? I said, that's an idea. So that's kind of what I started doing. And and found that not only could you make up the phone calls, but in the heyday of call-in radio, you get people to call, you know, because talk radio in those days had a very high level of credibility, you know, with listeners. And so it kind of took off from there, you know, and I had to experiment with it. I did sometimes when I was on in Minneapolis, I did 4 straight hours with the same character. I would keep on the same character, basically doing the same topic. It would get very weird in the middle of the night. And then when I finally got to Miami, I decided to do 1 character per hour. And that pretty much was the format that I stayed with through the next, I guess, 7 or 8 years, you know.
So in Irvine, and this is from one host to another. Now, I'm just going to pick your brain on this because it's very cool what you do. But in Irvine, are you're going to do the show?
No, I'm not going to do the radio show. The show that you and I are talking about right now, where the phone calls would come in, that show hasn't been around since around, I would say, 2011.
Right.
When social media really started to take the stuffing, I think, out of talk radio. And it was then that I decided to just do an improv sort of stylized presentation of a satire of a talk show. So what I'll do in Irvine and what I did in Hollywood in L.A., you know, the last 2 months is do character sketches on stage, go in and out of character on stage. So all I'm adding is the physicality, you know, and the audience will be able to see, and has been able to see, how I literally go from character to character right there physically, you know, what happens, you know, the body language.
Right.
And you know, the reality of the character.
One of the things I used to picture you in the studio, somehow maybe 2 microphones, 2 different microphones for 2 different sounds or something. I was picturing that, possibly a different set of effects, maybe that you were running on another microphone, either that or you're switching stuff in real time on the console. And so how did you pull that off? Was it 2 microphones or 3?
Yeah, I come from an old school, meaning I guess we're all old school. It just depends on what old school we are. You know, you may be old school as in the 90s. I'm old school from the 70s. But the fact is, we all, you know, radio's hands on, and we pretty much do what we do like craftsmen, you know. So I don't do anything fancier, Jimmy, than basically I'm on mic. And I've got a phone in my hand, and I'm switching between the microphone and the telephone.
Ah.
And the way I do the telephone, where there's no what we call bleed through, meaning you're not hearing the microphone as well as the telephone, is I pop the mic or I turn the mic down, and I'm doing it really fast. The effects you hear are just, I've got 3 or 4 or 5 different cell phone or phone effects that I use that I just roll on a loop behind the call. So it's really not anything. I remember people would say, okay, what processing do you use? And all these geeks, you know, would talk about what kind of equipment I must have. No, it's a telephone, and it's literally a black rotary phone, because it's an old phone, and you know, stuff like that. I mean, and I will tell you this, it's kind of some of the stuff we do on the show, you know, people don't do anymore. Like I used to do this character, this old lady who couldn't hang the phone up, you know.
Right.
Because I always used to notice that elderly people had a hard time putting the phone down in a cradle. Well, who uses a cradle phone anymore? You know, everybody uses a phone that you can switch off literally with a push of a button. So I miss kind of, I miss the days of, and the other thing is, just as you tonight had talked to, you know, my guys, you know, Gigi and Alex, and those guys, you were asking about Skype. Frankly, you're right. Most, you know, cats are using Skype now. How many people actually use telephones? And so, you know, you kind of have to, everything's changing, man. And all of those effects that you and I are talking about are really, some of them are outdated a little bit.
Yeah, I'm half old school, half new school. I still run an analog console. You know, I do.
Yeah.
Everything else, you've got to, things are computerized, but, and
right.
I run 3 computers at a time and so forth, but
yeah.
I still
yeah.
have the analog phone lines going into the analog console. And then I have a whole separate computer system that's running a bunch of different Skype channels too at the same time because you have to. But I'm a firm believer, and nothing sounds like analog. Nothing does. I've got a tube microphone. The microphone I'm using right now is a nice tube, big old diaphragm, stinky mic, but nothing sounds like that.
Yeah. Well, I'm the exact same setup as you. I've got six computers because I have a TriCaster, but my board is an old Mackie board, and my mic is a, I think it's an Electrovox. I can't remember, but we are going to go digital eventually. I mean, we're going to digitize everything because of the fact that the context, as cool as analog may be, the context get dirty. I know we're really getting into some geeky stuff.
We are.
Yeah. Every time I use a fader on an analog on my board, I'm hearing the contacts are kind of dirty, and you know, but by and large, what my show reflects from the standpoint of those phone calls is old school telephone technology, which is gradually, phasing out, as you said. And you know, tonight you guys were asking me about Skype. I know we've got a Skype channel somewhere down there, but it was kind of a hassle to go. Dig it out at this particular time of the night. I said, "Shit, you know, let's just go, on the phone." But all that stuff is pretty. You know, what it is, it still comes down to performance. I got a lot of stuff, and you got a lot of stuff, but we still have to perform. We still have to go into character. We still have to become entertainers, and none of that stuff would work were it not for the fact that, you know, I work really hard on characterization. I work really hard on the humor. I work really hard on improvising and drawing the most I can out of the day's events. Make stuff as real as I can and make it as funny as I can. And well, that's where it's at, you know.
Let me ask you this. After I listen to you go through a broadcast, go through a show, I'm thinking to myself, his brain has got to be so twisted up right now, in and out of so many different characters. When you're done and you walk out of the studio, just like I do every night, I'm exhausted after a show. Is your brain... like, do you have to untwist it? How do you think straight?
Oh, yeah. I don't remember what I've done on the air. I've sometimes had to call my producer. I've had to call people and say, what did I just do on the air tonight? If we're doing the show log, for instance, we're having to, we put together a show log for our website. I can't remember. I don't remember bits. I don't remember, you know. I can't tell you what I did on the air this morning. I can't tell you what I just can't, you know, and nothing stays there, man, because you're thinking so much and the flow of stuff is happening so quickly. There's just no room in your head for anything other than what's going on at that particular moment. And then the other thing when you get off the air is, I don't know if you've ever been married to a woman or been with anybody that really talked a lot, you know, and you get off the air at 10 or 11 or 12 o'clock at night, you do not have anything to say to anybody, you know?
No.
And whoever is in your life has got to understand that this is, you know, you just don't want to have a conversation. So I'm kind of antisocial too when it comes to that stuff.
Now tell me the truth, Phil. Do you ever call up like Time Warner and you got to discuss your bill and you just go into character? Tell me the truth.
No, I don't do that. I've maybe made two crank calls in my whole life to a radio show, but I don't, because, it's kind of like if you do that for a living or if you do that professionally, how weird is that just doing it when you're not working?
It would be funny.
That's what I call mental illness, you know.
It would be funny as hell to listen to, though, that's for sure.
maybe, you know. Time Warner, I wouldn't mind doing it too.
Because, exactly.
They would deserve it, yeah.
When your callers call in and they are completely outraged about whatever it is that, you know, you're in character about and you've got an issue that's out on the streets, whatever it is, it could be whatever it's about. But when those callers come in and you've got them just fired up. I mean, have you ever had somebody that just wouldn't let it go?
Well, we haven't done that show for 3 years.
Right.
But back in those days, it reached its fever peak in Los Angeles when I would say it reached its fever peak in L.A. around 2004, 2003, when, you know, talk radio was at its most dangerous. You know, in other words, people were really taking it seriously.
Right.
And they really thought they were going to be changing the world with all this wonderful talk radio. And so, you know, every time they heard something on the air, they would call in and they wanted to, you know, they really wanted to engage. And yeah, we had moments on the air where it just got, it was insane, man. It was insane. It was like people calling in to talk about whether witches and goblins exist, you know, you know, and having long conversations with guys that were, you know, wanting to have, you know, give you a cafe latte enema, you know, and weird stuff like, yeah, you know, it would definitely transcend. I used to say that I was most proud of the show. And I think that any good radio show transcends radio and it becomes something that you're eavesdropping on. You know, you're eavesdropping in on, you don't know whether you're listening to a radio show or whether it's a real thing that's happening. And I am proud to say, I think we hit that height a lot, you know, but that was when it really got to that explosive point. And it would be great, you know, but it also was constricting because the show became about fooling phone callers.
Yes.
And all of the other stuff got lost, I think, in a lot of ways. The satire of it, the art of it. And because what we were doing, and what I like to think I still do, is an artistic presentation. You know, it's entertainment.
Right.
And radio is a very curious medium. It's the only medium that I can think of that has a real disdain for talent. It doesn't have a great deal it doesn't take a great deal of joy in the talent that it creates. It's troubled by talent. It's bothered by it. It's constantly a nuisance. The better our show got, the less understood it was by a lot of people. And it even got to the point where it got so good that people were outraged that it was so, you know, effectively satirical.
Right,
you know, as
right.
opposed to raising it up and saying, well, here's a really an example of the best we can do in our medium. We had a lot of people, the same thing has happened to a lot of people that I know and have seen in this business. Howard Stern is a guy who has changed radio, and yet the business rejected him outright for years and years and years. Didn't want to even know the guy existed. So I would say at the very best that our show got, it was, it probably had its most trouble in terms of being embraced and really raised up by the medium. But it was great radio. But because it was so good, it also pissed a lot of people off. Because, you know, satire is humor with a point of view, and that really makes people angry. So that and then it kind of trailed out because Facebook and Twitter and all of the social media mediums began to take all of that piss and vinegar, and people had another place where they could vent it. They didn't need to call the talk show. They had their own little talk radio platform there with Facebook pages and stuff.
Sure, sure.
So, yeah, I would say, Jimmy, there was a period of about 3-4 years where it really became almost like a fever and then, you know, dissipated.
Well, I got to tell you, there were times I almost crashed my car. You know, I'm riding around and I'm listening and I'm breaking out in a sweat, and it was right on the razor's edge, and it was right there, man. And I was panicking for you. I mean, I'm serious too. And if it was like that for me, you're talking, I don't know. I have no idea what the ratings were back then with KFI, but you're certainly right. It was a peak. It was a serious peak of AM radio stuff going on, and you were right there in the middle of it. And so I wasn't the only one. I'm telling you, I was white knuckle guy listening to this. Man.
Well, I mean, and the thing of it is you just take it and push it because you have no choice but to push it. You know, if you have a guy, if you have people that are calling and they have completely bought into some absurd or crazy or insane premise, and they're really, really, you know, and they want to go even further out, you all you can do is push it, and all you can do is just keep on taking it as far out as you can until it gets to a point where you think, you know, maybe you're, you know, being irresponsible here. Like a guy called in one time, and people will do this. People try to control the emotional content of the show. They don't like the fact that you're doing what you're doing. So what they'll do is they'll call up and they'll say something really emotionally explosive that they think is going to turn the show in their favor. Like, for instance, this guy calling my show one night and talking about, you know something, buddy, I don't know what, but you know, my daughter died in an automobile accident. She died. So I'm thinking, I've dealt with callers like that a million times. What they're trying to do is explode the momentum you have by interjecting some devastating emotional note. We don't, you know, ever let them do that. So the character I had on was this old character by the name of Harvey Wyman. He says, my daughter died. And Harvey goes, I'll bet she was a piece of ass. That's so bad. You know? And so, you know, and what that does is it immediately, the audience suspects that that's what the guy's doing. But as soon as we say, I'll bet she was a piece of ass, the audience is convinced then that that's what the guy's doing, because that's how we replied to it. We basically, you know, took it to its absurd level, and it's absurd extreme. Because if that guy says, how dare you talk to me about my daughter, I can come back with, well, how dare you bring that up? You know, how,
right.
How dare you call in with such a comment? So those were the times.
How did you? I don't mean to cut you off, but I have to ask you before you. How do you keep from laughing? And you're going to be at
you can put your hand over your mouth, or you can pop the mic down, but you don't really.
But you're going to do this tomorrow night. You're going to be in and out of character tomorrow night live, and you know how because you're you know how do you? I know it's an immense amount of control and practice. You've been doing this for years. But seriously, you're funny, and you know you're funny. And so how do you keep from doing that? Robin Williams would lose it once in a while, too, as well, and not maintain his self-control. How do you do it?
Well, I mean, you just if you're in character, you're not going to necessarily be at a place where you're thinking anything's funny. You're in character thinking you're, you know, serious. And, you know, like, you know, yeah, I got a character named Jay Sanis of the Citizens Auxiliary Police, and he may be standing up there talking about the fact that, you know, I'm going to have to, I'm sorry I have to say this to you, but I will have to take a nasal swab and swab the inside of your nose to see if you got anthrax up there. You know, now that sounds ridiculous, and anybody would be shocked and outraged if somebody tried to take a Q-tip to their nose. But for Jay, that's serious business. So if you're in character, you're not gonna, but every now and again something hits you and you realize the ridiculousness of it. You visualize it. That's when you start to laugh. When you visualize something that you're saying, that's when you lose it.
Tomorrow night, so, you're going to be at the Improv down in Irvine, and I love it. It's weird too, because the Improv down there, and I'm sure you've been there, but it's like in a little shopping mall.
I haven't been to the Irvine Improv.
Oh, okay.
But I know it's big. I know it's got a lot of seats.
That's what I'm saying. It's big. You look at it, and well, anyway, so you're going to be down there tomorrow. It's on Fortune Drive down in Irvine, and it's called, and I love this, Truth is Our Bitch. Tell everybody, I want everybody to go down. I know that it's nearly sold out, but if you're going to be down in Irvine tomorrow, you're going to want to go see this. You've only done this type of show, I understand, three times. This is the third?
Yeah, this will be the third one. We did originally the Sketch Fest in San Francisco in January, and then we did two shows at the Hollywood Improv in June and July. So, exactly. And I'm sorry, you know, you can't make the joke, but we will definitely do a show in one of your off hours. I don't know when that will be. But
I'll notify Gigi.
I hope we're in the same city when we do it, you know, so you can actually come and see it. But.
Yeah, Jimmy, we're doing it Friday night. You're off Friday in Spokane.
Exactly. Oh, yeah.
So, I wish I could make it tomorrow night. Thank you for coming out. And so we'll... Maybe in the next couple of weeks, we'll get you back on when you're free, when you're available, and we'll spend some genuine time together, and I'm really looking forward to it. Thank you, Phil.
Thank you very much, Jimmy. Appreciate it, man.
All the best. Phil Hendrie, everybody.
All right, brother.
Thank you, Phil.
All right, buddy.
All the best. Phil Hendrie, everybody. Now, I will say this. Everybody ask for Phil Hendrie And I just gave them to you. Okay. Phil Hendrie will be live tomorrow night at the Improv. It's 8 o'clock, September 11th, tomorrow night at the Improv. Admission is $18. There's only so many tickets left. It's almost sold out. So, fade or nots, tomorrow night, you want to go check out Phil Hendrie. This is the thing. The man is a genius going in and out of character. It's what he does. And I cannot believe I am going to miss it tomorrow night. I am really super bummed out about that. So there you go. Phil Hendrie tomorrow night. Let's take a quick break. When I come back, that's right, Stanton T. Friedman will be in the house. This is Fade to Black. Only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Shoot me an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Follow us on Twitter. I don't know what's going on with Twitter. You guys have way confused me tonight. @JChurchRadio. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Are you afraid of the dark? Don't move. Don't touch that mouse. You are listening to Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses on jimmychurchradio.com.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter.
You're listening to Fade to Black
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Everybody, welcome back. Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your humble host, Jimmy Church. Follow us on Twitter @JChurchRadio. That is what you want to do. #DMRadioNet. I know my tweet deck isn't open tonight, and I'm kind of bummed. I can't hang out like I normally do, but you know what? You guys all are behaving, okay? All right? But I would like to welcome right now Stanton Friedman, nuclear physicist, lecturer Stanton T. Friedman. The T is there to separate him from all the other Stan Friedmans out there. Received his BSc and MSc degrees in physics from the University of Chicago in 1955. He was employed for 14 years as a nuclear physicist at GE, GM, Westinghouse, TRW Systems, Aerojet, General Nucleonics, and McDonnell Douglas. Since 1967, he has lectured at 600 colleges, 100 professional groups in 20 countries. He has published more than 90 UFO papers. I'm sure it's more than that now. Has appeared on hundreds of radio and TV programs. He co-authored Crash at Corona, the definitive study of the Roswell incident. I have it right here. And Top Secret Magic. Mr. Friedman has provided written testimony to congressional hearings and has appeared twice on CNN. I would like to welcome back to the program Mr. Stanton T. Friedman. Stanton, how are you tonight, sir?
Well, it's late here in beautiful Fredericton, New Brunswick, but I'm okay.
Well, there's no snow yet. That's the main point.
Well, that's a plus. Last winter was the worst in the 34 years we've been here in terms of averaging around 4 feet of snow all the time on the grass, on the lawn.
I remember the last time you were on, I was, you know, out here, it was like 75 degrees. And you were telling me, you know, we got 6 feet of snow outside. I felt so bad. It's just weird. Technology will allow us to do this. But, you know, yeah, exactly. You are way up east and north. And New Brunswick, people need to understand, you're about 2 miles from Santa Claus. You know, you're up there.
Oh, no, we're not. We're only 73 miles east of beautiful downtown Holton, Maine, which is at the northeastern end of I-95.
How you doing, my friend? How are you doing?
Well, I'm doing pretty well. I had a heart attack. I had a couple stents put in. I seem to be getting along fine. Don't have as much energy maybe as I did before, but I'm keeping busy. Just gave a couple lectures in the last couple weeks down at conferences. And, you know, I've got more trips coming up, so I haven't stopped.
I just got a quick text in from a friend of ours, Michael, and he wanted to know what your feelings on, we're going to talk about all kinds of other things, but this was actually an interesting question. What do you think about Bigelow and MUFON?
Well, you mean the two of them together? Or
yes.
Separate?
Yes. Well, you know what? How about the before and after? Yes.
I know Bob Bigelow. I was one of the first people to get a research grant from him way back when. And frankly, I liked working with him. He could make up his mind. He did everything he said he would do when he said he would do it. I mean, you know, he's a billionaire, so he had to get there somehow. He didn't inherit all his money or anything. He worked for it. Sharp guy, and he wanted to go along on one of the research trips and be a fly on the wall, and he did just that. We went out in the plains of San Augustine in New Mexico. Stayed at a crummy motel, you know. He was like the rest of us. He is really separate from MUFON. I've been involved with MUFON right from the start, and I've spoken at more MUFON International Symposia than anybody. I was supposed to speak at this past July's, but my heart got in the way, so I didn't, but... Bob is sharp. He has done, he did a lot for UFO research. I don't think he was as much appreciated as he might have been because he wanted to listen to the proposals for research. That was after I had my grant. And some of the people thought, oh, no, just put out the money. And I think that was pretty stupid of the person who did that. He's no longer alive, so...
Okay.
But MUFON is changing its character. The old guard, like people like me and stuff, are slipping out the side door, so to speak. It's the best UFO group. It's not clear what the new direction will be, if anything. There are people in MUFON who don't like abduction research, who don't want to do it, or don't want to see it done, rather.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, it puts out a pretty good monthly journal, and I write I have written a column for it for many years. It's the group I refer people to if they want to learn how to investigate and stuff. They can become investigators. So, you know, there aren't a lot of choices out there. And... You know, how do you get professional standards for something like ufology? There have been no, perhaps, 12 PhD theses done, but that's pretty darn few. And we have a lot of people who aren't really up on some of the facts about flying saucers, the government cover-up, et cetera. So it's a tough row to hoe to get people well-educated, so they're willing to participate in a sensible fashion. There are some MUFON members who don't like the idea of abduction research, who don't like the idea of women having as much say as they do. I'm, for one, very interested in abduction research and in making sure the women make a contribution. So, you know, I don't agree with everything that's going on, but I do like some of the things that are going on. So, And Bigelow, I don't know whether he's going to be spending much more money or not. I wish we had more people like him, to tell you the truth.
Do you think, and I want to stay on this subject just for a little while longer, because it is an important one. But when it comes to Robert Bigelow, do you think that he knows something about the UFO subject that maybe the rest of us don't? Is he possibly privy to some information that maybe, you know, you haven't even been exposed to? Why his interest?
Well, I think he realizes, as any thinking person should, that we're dealing with a subject of potentially great importance for mankind's future. Where do we fit in the greater scheme of things? And when he first approached me many years ago, it was with, I didn't know who he was, he understood that there was a shortage of funding in ufology, and did I have any ideas about projects that could be done? And I said, oh, I have quite a few. Well, why don't you write some of them down and send them to me, and we'll see if maybe we can get together. So the next day I gave him a list, and then he said, you know, pick one, and I made up a proposal, and the next day after that, and within a week I had my money. I like people who can make decisions, and everything he said he would do, he did. And it was nice to have little things like when we're going out, the Plains of San Augustine is west of Roswell, out in the, near where the Very Large Array Radio Telescope is, middle of nowhere. And it is a place where there was a flying saucer crash. But he was saying, when I was describing how we were going to get there, he said, well, don't you think we can take a helicopter down from Albuquerque? And I said, well, let me check. And I called him back in a few hours. I had a price. He said, yep, let's do it. So we did it. Saved a lot of trouble, frankly. And it was the same with several other things. Were you planning on getting the date on certain documents or letters that had been written? I said, if I can get hold of the originals, not Xerox copies, and within 2 days, I found the best place to do that kind of document stuff and got an approval and sent the stuff off. So it's nice to work with somebody who wants to get the job done.
And can
not
get
really
it done.
Not dally around.
Right, right. When did he expect, and I like MUFON and they are important, and I don't want to paint the wrong picture here with the wrong question, but do you think that he got into MUFON and started going through those case files and maybe backed off for a reason? You know, what was his intention with that? I mean, I don't want to say the wrong thing here. I don't. I don't want to misrepresent MUFON or Robert Bigelow either, but something happened.
John Carpenter, a psychologist, provided a number of files. Some people were upset about that. There's a certain question of privacy and so forth, and Bob's pretty good about keeping names and so forth out of the view of people who shouldn't see them. I don't know that anything in particular happened. There were people who didn't seem to understand that you need to systematically categorize your data, collect it, review it, make it available, and so forth. Just having it gather space in somebody's filing cabinet isn't getting much done. And Bob's an action person. You know, if we're going to collect information, we got to do something with it. And I tend to agree with him on that score. So MUFON's gone through some management changes over the last few years. Part of it's old guard sort of stuff, and part of it they made a strange choice, and one of the guys who directed it for a while. We've got a good man now, younger than us old guys, anyway.
Right, right.
And so I'm optimistic, and I noticed that the last issue of the MUFON Journal had a lot of color pictures. We've never had that before. And so I'm an optimist about the future of MUFON, and there is growing action to do things properly about abductions and other things. Where we're going to wind up a year from now or 10 years from now, I don't know.
Well, this is my concern with MUFON, and I would love your opinion on it. I don't think they are big enough. Okay, I don't think they have, if you, and this is where I'm going. I don't think they're big enough. I don't think they have enough field people to investigate the amount of reports that they get in every single day. And I don't know who makes the choices of what gets investigated and what doesn't and what the criteria is. I don't know. But
state section directors pretty much are supposed to assign new reports out to investigators.
Yeah, and, you know, how many credible, very important sightings or incidents that are out there that don't ever get investigated because they don't have enough people?
Well, I don't know if that's the case. Most people, look, MUFON's been getting, let's say, roughly 700 or so sightings a month. A month.
That's insane.
It's been my experience that only 10% of the cases that get that take place get reported. So there's an enormous amount going on. But, you know, my focus is rather different. I'm not saying we should investigate every case that comes along. If you've got limited resources, let's go after the jugular. Let's go after the press for doing a lousy job. That's one of the things. Let's go after the SETI cultists for getting in the way and presenting a false picture about the whole question of extraterrestrial intelligence. In other words, the case is easy to make that there is a cover-up, that there are being, that our planet is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft, that we're dealing with a cosmic Watergate. These are things that are easy to establish. I do this in my lectures. It's not that hard. There's so much evidence. The problem is the nasty, noisy negativists that won't look at the evidence. They want to believe that there is evidence, and especially with the SETI community, want to totally ignore it. They're interested in listening for radio signals, and we just wait long enough, we're going to get some. Where people are sending signals using technology that's appropriate to us, who've only had long-distance radio since 1901.
Right.
One would think they could do better than that.
Well, what would you suggest? It's of my opinion, and my opinion means absolutely nothing, but it's better to have those radio telescopes pointed out there than to not do it at all. So that's...
But let's not misrepresent what you're doing. I'm not opposed to the use of radio telescopes to learn about the universe. Radio waves carry a lot of information. But if you're saying, oh, but you're interested in intelligent beings out there, search for extraterrestrial intelligence, then that's another question. You say, well, what data do we have? It's quite obvious that the SETI people have put forth not one iota of evidence that there's anybody out there sending us signals that we can intercept with the equipment we have. Not one bit of evidence. But they totally ignore the enormous amount of evidence that's available through ufology. I find that passingly strange. I'll let a psychiatrist try to explain it. They've often said that one of the subjects that there should be for another PhD thesis is the will not to believe, the resistance to new ideas by the entrenched culture of the SETI people. They won't look at the UFO evidence. They won't look at the large-scale scientific studies. They won't look at the proof of cosmic Watergate. They won't look at the technology that makes it possible to sensibly talk about coming here from elsewhere.
Right.
They totally ignore all that stuff.
Right.
Now, are you interested in extraterrestrial intelligence or aren't you?
Right.
They're not. They're interested in radio signals, which is nice, I guess, if you're working on radio. But, you know, let's face it, if aliens are coming here, as they certainly are, then who needs SETI? Now, admittedly, the aliens don't seem to be wanting to talk to society as a whole. If they wanted to communicate with all of us, surely they could figure out how to, you know, land in the middle of the world soccer matches or something. Wouldn't that do it? Boy.
Yeah. Soon.
That's not their purpose, obviously.
If you had Bigelow's checkbook, which you almost did, but if you had his checkbook, what would you do different?
He's got an interest in space, and you know he's got systems up there right now as we speak. One of the private companies, and I'm all for privatization of the space program. I worked on government-sponsored programs. And, you know, if the government ran a computer industry, we'd have a choice of four models, and they'd be 1,000 times less good than the ones we have, and it would be very expensive. One of the things about capitalism is the right to fail. Plenty of computer companies have gone out of business, but the good guys get rewarded.
Mm-hmm.
So I think if I had Bigelow's checkbook, there are a number of things I would like to see. One would be stimulation of theses in graduate schools. Another would be collections in an appropriate fashion of the best cases, not just a little bit here and a little bit there. It takes money for that, of course. Bigelow's got the money, whether he wants to do it or not. You see, you can make the case that we already know that aliens are visiting. We don't need to be gathering data in that direction. Now the question is, what do they want? Why isn't the government telling us what it knows? Has there been contact between the government and the aliens? I don't know. I suspect there have been. And there is a book out about, Art Campbell has published a book in which he goes into perhaps two instances where Ike met with aliens. That may sound extraordinary, but of all the presidents, he's the one who knew most about security, you know, and had to learn how to deal in a strange environment. You know, think about it for a minute. Ike's job after the war and before he was elected president was to try to get Germany to work with England, France, and the United States to put up a barrier against Russia, which sounds reasonable until you realize we just fought two wars with Germany. How did he get them to cooperate? You know, not many people could have done that.
Right, right, right.
And so the question of how do you deal with aliens, the old American way is shoot first, ask questions later, you know.
Yes.
People forget.
Yes.
We have many systems geared toward monitoring the skies, satellites, air defense commands, aircraft. We're keeping track of what's going on. We're trying. And so do many other countries have such systems. We haven't learned how to get our act together, and that's something that's very badly needed on this planet. How many people think of themselves as Earthlings instead of Americans, Chinese, Greeks, Peruvians, whatever the nationalistic labels are that we have?
I'll answer that. None. Well, no, I don't. I do. I do. But yes, you're absolutely right in that. Well, you know, that's what, you know, that's what Reagan tried to, you know, when he was doing his kumbaya thing at the United Nations. He definitely tried to get us to change our views of the way that we looked at each other and borders and so forth, and uniting everybody. I get that, but that's exactly what he was saying. So I would say, oh man, I don't know how many, less than 1% of the world.
I don't think so. And that's, you know, when there are some people pushing for disclosure the government should tell us everything they know. I don't agree with that.
Why?
Well, because I think there is a national security aspect. If we've learned new technology, why should the United States put it on the table if the Russians and Chinese don't put it on the table?
But wouldn't that turn us all into earthlings?
No, just competitive nationalistic groups. I think if we make an announcement that indeed Earth is being visited, you know, I my favorite choice for people to make the announcement is the Queen and the Pope. You know, an interesting couple, you might say. I think if you make any such announcement, it's got to be with the idea that there will be international conferences about the religious, philosophical, technological, economic impact of all that. Right now, there's nobody who speaks for the planet. Aliens may be stealing lots of goodies from us, rare earths and other things. You know, people forget. 100 years ago, the major use for uranium was as a colorant for a nice yellow color for plates, dinner plates. That's illegal now because uranium is radioactive. It was radioactive then too, but you know.
right.
And the Navy is based on the use of zirconium. How many people have ever heard of zirconium? But maybe the aliens have been stealing it. You know, rare earths. Now, if you buy a Prius and these other vehicles like that, you'll see rare earths. And China has cornered the market about 90% last time I looked. And, you know, what are we doing as a planet about our resources? Who's using the bottom of the ocean to recover resources instead of to hide nuclear-powered submarines with missiles ready to dump on somebody who dumps a missile on us? The planet is simply not given, at this point, much attention to how do we turn it into a better place to be.
But who would be, Stanton, seriously, who would be shocked today if it was disclosed that E.T. has been here, is here, has been visiting us, we've got deals with him, we've been exchanging. Well, who would be shocked?
Robertson.
I mean, seriously, who would be shocked? I don't think there's any religion in the world that would flip out anymore. I don't think there'd be rioting in the streets. I would think it would
be
the exact
opposite. No, I didn't say there would be, but I think we need to have open discussions. Seriously, look, the Vatican has sent, I've been at conferences where the Vatican has had representative Father Baldacci, met him. And I was shocked when the Pope said just a few years ago that there's no reason to say that God didn't make our brethren in outer space just as he made us. And my first reaction to that was, who's he been talking to? You know,
I'm laughing with you on that one. But seriously, who would be shocked? The argument has always been, apparently, the argument has been, disclosure happens, mayhem ensues, everything collapses, the economy, religion.
Well, I haven't been making that argument. People keep referring back to War of the Worlds.
Sure, they do, yes.
Yeah, except that it's foolish. Let's face it. That happened in New Jersey in 1938, and it was presented as a news program on radio, guy, you know, before television. And the statements were made that the earthlings in New Jerseyites were being killed and the buildings were being destroyed and so forth and so on. And they had a right to panic. You know, this is before the space age and was even a glint in somebody's eye, space program. And so you can't blame people for getting concerned. Bad things are happening and there's nothing we can do about it. And what do we do now for our kids? But, you know, what's her name? Jacobson tried to make a case that the Russians, with Dr. Mengele, no less, had put up deformed young people in a craft that was supposed to crash and cause panic, just like 1938. Now, contrast New Jersey with New Mexico. Ain't nobody there, man. So I'm not saying that it would cause panic. I normally give six reasons for the cover-up, or at least five, and none of them includes fear of panic. The first is you want to figure out how the darn things work. They make wonderful weapons delivery and defense systems. We spend a lot of money on that sort of thing. You've got wreckage from Roswell and Aztec and probably several other places. You set up your secret project. Rule number one for secrecy is you can't tell your friends without telling your enemies. They read the newspapers and listen to the radio, too, you know.
Sure.
Second problem is the other side of the same coin. What if our enemies figure out how they work before we do?
Right.
How do we defend against them? We don't want them to know. We know. They know. Bigger spears, stronger shields, et cetera. That game's been going on for a long time. The third problem is, it's related to what we were just talking about, if an announcement were to be made by the Queen and the Pope or any other odd couple you happen to think of, that would push a lot of people, especially today, into saying, into considering themselves, identifying themselves as Earthlings. As opposed to, you know, French, English, German, et cetera. I know of no country on this planet that wants its citizens to owe their primary allegiance to the planet instead of that individual country. Nationalism seems to be the only game in town, as far as I can tell. And you say, well, we'll hold an election to see who speaks for the planet. Really? Chinese got 1.3 billion people, India a billion, the United States only 310 million. We're going to let it be one vote, one person? No way, Jose. The fourth problem is, again, the fundamentalists. Now, Pat Robertson has said, all the intelligent life in the universe is on Earth, and this UFO stuff is the work of the devil. And the whole planet was created in 4004 BC. I think it was a Thursday afternoon.
Anyway. Oh, Stan. Oh, man.
Well, he's got... I've met... some of his followers.
Yes.
Assistant.
Yes. You know. Yes, yes, yes. I have a friend, and we're going to get to point number five in a second, but I have a friend, his name's Lane, who will look at, he's the funniest guy, he's the coolest guy, feet on the ground, awesome, awesome guy. But he will look at you right in your eyeballs and tell you, 6,000 years, man, it's it. Everything. And I, what about dinosaur bones? God put that on the earth, man, to test us. Okay,
that's and he made the Grand Canyon too.
Yeah, right. Okay, so anyway, point number five.
People have said to me, "Look, Stan, if aliens are coming here and we're not going there, that means they're more advanced technologically than we are. So maybe if we keep at it, there will be new methods of energy production. We copy these guys, and there goes the oil companies and the gas companies. New methods of ground and air transport. There goes the car and plane companies." New methods for communication and computers and, you know, economic chaos. Doesn't that worry you? And I say, no, I have no sympathy for the buggy whip manufacturers who went out of business when the cars took over from the horses. You know, that's the way things go. The sixth problem is I have, on seven different occasions, been quietly told by people after my lectures about being at military bases where pilots went up to go after UFOs and never came back. People forget the directive, that's a nice word for that, was to pilots, military pilots in the early 50s. 1952 was the biggest year in Project Blue Book history. And the rule went out, shoot them down if they don't land when instructed to do so. Incidentally, that story didn't appear in the New York Times or the Washington Post for some strange reason. It did appear in the Louisville Courier Journal and a number of quite respectable newspapers. And if you look at Frank Ficino's excellent book about the Flatwoods case, he's got 200 instances from the New York Times between 1951 and 56 of airplanes having fatal crashes. That is, the pilot was killed, military planes in the U.S. Five of those pilots, great words were used by the New York Times. They said, in some cases, disintegrated and disappeared. kind of strange words to use.
Mm-hmm.
And in five cases, the pilots were veterans of the Korean War that had flown over 100 missions. And there were MiGs trying to shoot them down. So if you survive 100 missions in Korea, you're a pretty good pilot.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, as a general rule. And you come back to the United States and there's no MiGs and you crash?
Right.
That seems a little odd. As I said, I've had seven people. And if seven people have talked to me quietly, there are going to be a lot more cases than that. And their families weren't told anything. And I've got people saying, oh, come on, Stan, the families would have been told, only that they died, body's not recovered, et cetera. And to give proof of that, there's a book called By Any Means Necessary by William Burroughs about 166 U.S. military guys who were in planes that were, I love the phrase, tickling the radar in North Korea, Russia, and China after the war. They'd zip in, see how fast the radar came on, what frequency was used, you know, all this kind of stuff, just in case we had to fight a war. And a lot of planes got shot down. There was not one word in public about that. Of course, we shot down some Russian planes doing exactly the same thing.
Sure.
And didn't say anything about that either. So it's no surprise that families weren't told. As a matter of fact, there was a conference call in 2001 where medals were given to the families that their kin had earned, and they were told as much as possible about what had happened. A lot of these planes weren't immediately disintegrated, our planes over there. I mean, we're violating some international laws and stuff like that, but we don't want to talk about that, I guess. So there was radio transmissions and stuff, and there was not one word in public. I say this because there's still people who think governments can't keep secrets, which is an extraordinary claim. They're keeping secrets all the time. Well, one that hasn't had much attention in the press was a statement by General Carol Bolander, Air Force General, who was given the assignment after the Condon report came out in early 69. What should we do about Project Blue Book? We need a position on that. The Condon report had suggested that it be closed. It wasn't contributing anything. And I tend to agree with that, but that's another story. Anyway, Bolander wrote a memo. He had no previous connection with it. He worked on the lunar excursion module. Good engineer, general, brigadier general. And so he wrote a memo, which we didn't see until 10 years later. This is in October of 69. And as a result of his memo, the Blue Book was closed. In the memo, he said, reports of UFOs which could affect national security are made in accordance with JNAP, Joint Army Navy Air Force Publication 146, or Air Force Manual 55-11, and are not part of the Blue Book system. Now, that's an extraordinary claim. Two paragraphs later, he says, if we close Project Blue Book, the public won't have a place to report UFO sightings. However, as previously noted, reports which could affect national security will continue to be investigated using the procedures designed for that purpose. Now, again, an extraordinary claim, because when Blue Book was closed and ever since, the Air Force is saying, we aren't doing anything about UFOs. There is no security aspect. Nothing to worry about, folks. They were lying through their teeth. Anyway, I located Bolander 10 years later. I like looking for people who have little unusual names. They're much easier to find than the John Smiths of the world.
That's right.
And I said, I gave him some of my background, said I'd had a clearance for 14 years and worked on advanced propulsion, stuff like that. I said, I was intrigued by your memo. It seems to me that you were saying that there were two separate reporting channels. One for cases that could affect national security. The example I gave him, I said, suppose a saucer is flying down the runway at a SAC base where nuclear weapons are stored. And I've had reports like that. That, by definition, would affect national security because not supposed to be anybody there on the SAC base who doesn't have a clearance. I said, the other channel would be for Joe Blow and me standing outside in the street and watching a saucer go over. Big deal. Happens all the time. He agreed with me. And I wish I could say you could interview him, but he's dead, unfortunately. But no major media group has ever talked about General Bolander's statements. And how much more do you want? An Air Force general worked on the lunar excursion module. Very good background. I did some checking on him. You don't pick your worst guys to work on the lunar excursion module.
That's right. That is exactly right.
And so that's just one example. Another, I'd like to see somebody take all 156 top secret Umbra NSA UFO documents, which you can get under Freedom of Information. I mean, they're not very exciting. You can read one line per page. Everything else is whited out. Strange as that might sound. And there's a bunch of blacked out CIA top secret number of UFO documents. So where's the media? And as another example of that, the fourth explanation for Roswell had to do with this crash test dummy nonsense.
The 5 year late and incorrect. Yes. Yeah, 6 year late. Hey, Stanton, really quick. I have a friend that just called in. He wants to say hi to you. Just real quick. Hey, okay. Dino, say hi to Stan Friedman.
Hi, Stan. I don't want to interrupt your wonderful subject. You're one of the cornerstones of our beliefs and movement here.
good.
But I'd like to hear you talk more, and I hope you're feeling good and better. But
yeah.
I'd like to hear more. There seems to be a discrepancy here. You remind me of a professor I had who is still alive to this day and lives in my town. But I guess the question is, when I've been reading or just finishing Richard Dolan and what's-his-name's book on AD after disclosure, and you were being the...
Bryce Sable.
Bryce Sable, and the credentials that you have as a nuclear physicist, and the wonderful many times whenever you speak, but when you spoke in 2013 at the disclosure hearings that we're working on here, and I'm a little perplexed that you're saying you don't think disclosure is a good idea when we keep hearing all these hints and, you know, the government's keeping secrets and a lot of what you said. I'd like you to talk more about that, because I think Mr. Dolan and his co-author have really tried to think through a lot of the different things that could happen under disclosure. We're not guaranteed the religion's going to be one way or the other. We're not guaranteed whether there's going to be mayhem in the streets or not. I think everybody should read that book. And what are your thoughts on it? And are you going to testify again if we do another disclosure hearing in Congress?
Thank you, Dino.
Well, if I get asked, I probably would. I went sort of out of self-defense, not because I was wildly enthusiastic about disclosure, which I wasn't. But I know I would be asked about it, and I wanted to be there firsthand to know, and they offered to bring me in. And also, many of the people there didn't know much about security. Steve Greer was one, for example, and they gave him a lot of time. I wanted to put some sense about today's world and how security works and how easy it is to keep secrets and so forth. I am for informing the world that the planet's being visited. I am not for everything being released, some crazy notion that we're all entitled to know. Look, the Washington Post just had an article a year ago, maybe inspired by Mr. Snowden, I don't know, in which they said that the past year's black budget for military intelligence work was $52.6 billion. Boy, that's a lot of money. And the three top culprits were the NSA, CIA, and NRO, National Reconnaissance Office. And, you know, that makes any academic budget look pretty small, doesn't it?
It does.
So So what I'm saying is, there's a difference between saying we need to know, have some idea of what's going on, and saying everything should be put out on the table. And I don't think everything should be put out on the table. But I recognize the difficulty for governments, especially the smaller countries, and how do you keep your identity? People in power, at least my perception, is that people in power want to stay in power.
Sure.
You know, any, ever see anybody in power who didn't want to stay in power? You know, I don't know.
It's like heroin. It's like heroin. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you're stuck.
You're stuck. You're stuck.
And so I was there. I had my say. Sometime soon there's supposed to be a TV or a DVD which will go through all this stuff, and you can see what everybody said. I was intrigued by the response of the panelists. I think amongst them they had 80 years of service in Congress, either Senate or the House of Representatives. And they started off clearly ignorant.
Completely.
And as time went on, they got sharper, I felt. And so I was impressed with that. And remember, I'm the only one who was there who also testified at the congressional hearing, the real congressional hearing, provided testimony to the real congressional hearings of 1968. There's testimony from 12 scientists. I was the only one without a PhD. I take pride. And I was the youngest, too. That's why I'm still alive. And
well,
the other guys don't.
Let me ask you about that. The view, what was the attitude like in 1968? Was it genuine or was it theatrics?
No, it was genuine. Remember, these were not really public. It wasn't a public hearing in that sense. Six scientists testified in person, six more of us in writing, and the written testimony. That's actually
Yeah. I'm not referring to the presenters. I'm referring to the politicians that were there. Were the politicians there because they wanted to be and they were concerned, or was it theatrics on their part and they were just required to be there?
It was a mix. If you read the testimony is available in a 247-page report, and I believe it's on the internet. Symposium on UFO sponsored by the House Committee on Science and Technology on my birthday, July 29th. 1968.
You were 29.
Let's see. I was born in 34, so I was a little more than 29. I was 34.
Let me ask you a couple of. I want to swing to the left a little bit. This just came in from Twitter, and I would love your thoughts on this. The Black Knight satellite. What do you think is really going on with that? With everything that happened back in the 30s with the original reports on this, and then, of course, the orbit that it was in and so forth. What do you think the Black Knight satellite really is?
It's still in my gray basket. It's one of those subjects where there's so much stuff. You look at it and say, where's the evidence? How can you come to a rational conclusion? Everybody wants to say yes or no to stuff. And sometimes I have to say, I don't know enough to have an opinion about that. I get asked about stuff that's on YouTube. And, you know, take a quick look and give me your opinion. I'm not going to do that. What's the point? Throw darts at a dartboard, you know. Yes or no, maybe. So I don't know.
It's a fascinating, if it is, you know, 13,000 years old and it's been here for a long time and we've known about its orbit, the pictures being pulled down, you know, off the official NASA website. NASA wants to say it's a seat from the shuttle or whatever, it's a fascinating subject. I don't know.
It is fascinating. I'll grant you that, but it takes time, effort, and money to dig into these things.
Rick Sinnott just tweeted, what do you think about Skinwalker Ranch, and what do you think is really going on?
Well, I think I appreciate Bigelow's, you know, the guys buying it so they could study what was going on. A lot of strange stuff going on. People seeing vehicles and so forth. The inside story, again, I don't know what it is. Obviously, there was enough. George Knapp, who's a fine journalist, got involved in finding out some of what was going on. He co-authored the book, I believe. And so it's a place where a lot of strange things have happened. It's not the only place, but we live in a world in which the press seems to feel, in general, that we don't want to dig into the strange stuff going on. You know, that's too much trouble. It's easy to cover it like sports. There's a new game every day. We know the basic rules, and why worry about anything strange? You know, the average, there was a time, the Santa Ana newspaper in California did have a weekly column on UFOs. But that's kind of an exception as to the extent of press coverage. And as a matter of fact, in my paper for MUFON, which I just presented last week because I couldn't go to the MUFON conference because of my heart attack, I quoted from a PhD thesis done on press coverage of UFOs, which had some scathing comments about how bad it was, failure to deal with the data and so forth and so on. There have been others, but this one was the finest one I could find, and I quoted from it. And, you know, get the MUFON proceedings, and you can see the whole paper. But, we have a problem in that people are fearful of ridicule. Even though I've only had 11 hecklers in over 700 lectures, and I come on pretty darn strong.
Only 11? Come on, Stan.
Only 11, and it's been a long time since.
It sounds
I present facts and data. I raise the objections, and I demolish them. Now, I'll admit, the strongest, nasty, noisy negativists aren't going to go to my lecture. They wouldn't be caught dead, you know, at a UFO lecture, but... what I'm saying is I've done hundreds of shows and hundreds of lectures. And let me give you an example of the problem from their viewpoint. State University of New York in Cortland, New York. There's a whole bunch of different campuses under SUNY, State University of New York. End of my lecture, had a full house. Guy gets up, and I'm indiscriminate. Whoever gets up first raises hand. I call on them. No written questions required, nothing like that. And he starts off with a real zinger. I've never heard so much nonsense in one night in my life. My response, I'm pleased, although I couldn't have told you what I would have said if I could tell you what I did say. Can you be more specific, please, sir? You said that Betty and Barney Hill were taken to Zeta Reticuli and back in 2 hours. I said, no, sir. What I said was they were taken on board a craft for 2 hours. He didn't go anywhere. He came up with two more you said that's, which are equally off the wall. And somebody in the audience shouted, how about taking some sensible questions? This guy gets up and leaves. He nicely dressed, spoke well. So I said, look, I'll take your question, but who was that? He was a professor of physics. He hadn't heard what I said at all. You know, he knew what he expected some nutter was talking about flying saucers would say. That's what he heard.
Right.
And so it was not a sensible questioning of fact or data. And now remember, I'm a little sneaky, I'll grant you. When I talk about five large-scale scientific studies, I usually ask after each one. I tell what's in it and show some slides and so forth. I say, how many people here have read this? And if I'm lucky, it's 1 or 2%.
Right.
So if a guy hasn't read any of the stuff I've talked about, generally, you'd think he'd be hesitant to speak up. You know? But and so I've been out there. I'll tell you something else. At the end of my lecture, I ask how many people here believe they've seen what I would consider to be a flying saucer.
I've seen you do it.
I define my terms.
Right. I've seen you do it. Right.
And the hands go up reluctantly, and I point and count 1, 2, 3, 4. The time I get to the far side of the room, the hands go up vigorously. each one thought he was the only one. The time I'm finished, it's 10% believe they've seen one. That's a rough number. So maybe it's 8% here and 12% there. It doesn't matter. Then I ask, how many of you reported what you saw?
No hands.
Well, 90% of the hands go down.
Right.
And then I'll ask, if there's still some people, how many of you were in the military at the time? Still got somebody, and I've talked to some big crowds, so there's plenty of warm bodies out there.
Sure.
When I ask about how many of you were in the military, and some hands go up, I say, how, you want to tell us about it? One guy in front of 1,300 people in Texas says, I can't. They told me not to say anything. Great line. Another guy in Indiana says, they took my pictures. That's all he said. So I said to him, look, I'm sure the audience would love to hear what you have to say. I'm not asking your name. You don't need to stand up. And the audience clapped. He remained seated and told us about flying a four-engine aircraft, Air Force plane, over the Pacific, plane 20 miles ahead, radios back, that saucer heading your way. They had gun cameras. They took pictures. They called the base to which they were flying. The film was picked up when they landed. The crew doesn't handle film. That's intelligence stuff. The crew got debriefed and told never to say anything. And I would bet 99.9% of the people in that audience believed him because he just came across so straight. You know, he wasn't seeking attention. He was being honest. And so I've been out there, and I know that fear of ridicule is a major problem. Most people think that most other people don't believe there's anything to the subject, even though they do. You know, the polls have shown that. The greater the education, the more likely to believe in flying saucers, believe it or not. But part of the problem is that the nasty, noisy negativists, that's what I call them when I'm being polite, you understand.
Have you ever used a bad word?
On stage, you mean?
Just in general. I'm just, you're upset that they don't have the right tomato sauce at the supermarket. Do you go off?
No, then I don't. Talking about some of the anti-UFO people, I might. But not usually in public. So.
One day I'm going to get you to go there. But what about, I want to jump back. I don't know. Have you seen the discovery, the Malibu deep underwater base stuff that we presented?
I did see those pictures. And looking at it, I'm not convinced that it's artificial. The spacing wasn't nearly as consistent as you'd expect it to be if it was artificial. What the heck it is, I don't know.
It's interesting, isn't it?
There's loads of interesting things. There are anomalies all over the place. And unfortunately, our universities are set up to avoid dealing with anomalies. They want to deal with the known, you know,
right,
and make a little change. Although one interesting finding, it was just announced yesterday, I think, that they found one of the ships of the Franklin Expedition.
I did see that, yes.
And that's a historic find, under 11 meters of water, I think. So new things do turn up, fortunately.
Well, you were talking earlier about the column that was in the Santa Ana paper. And right when you said that, too, it just reminded me of Rex Heflin. But and we're going to get to that in a second.
Yeah, right but, guy.
Yeah, but when ABC News came to me about the Malibu base, right, and they wanted to talk about it, and I said, look, we're going to do it. We're going to treat you right. Don't worry about it. It's going to be great. We're going to do this feature on it. And I said, okay, all right, just as long as – and no, Jimmy, it's going to be cool. So they come out to the studio, and they interview me. And now I don't want to misrepresent ABC News, but I will say that they came in and they spent about 20 minutes with me here in the studio, and they did ask me some genuine, and they said, okay, now what else would you like to say? And I said, well, you know, it's about integrity. It's about, you know, what this represents to ufology and not since Area 51 have we had something that we can actually go and look at, and it's very important for all of us to do some serious research. Everything that that was credible or would shine a light in the correct way on this was not it was on the cutting room floor. In the end, it was just a funny story for them to talk about. And was it disappointing? Well, you know, I was happy on one side that they actually took the time to put it out on the air. And they did, and they did it nationwide. What was the serious part? All of that was it was ignored. And it was really, that's the way that mass media, when it comes to UFO reports, anyone, you know, go watch any newscast on YouTube about a UFO sighting. And in the end, they got the funny tagline. You know what I mean?
Yeah, or the music from one of the shows. Or
it's sad. It's really sad. Oh, anyway, Rex Heflin.
Yes.
I wanted to, you know, when it comes.
Good pictures.
Yes. And with and Anne Druffel has those in her possession, by the way. And so out of everything out there, for me, Rex Heflin is right there. McMinnville is there too as well. But Rex Heflin's pictures are stunning. And for that, for me, I think it's some of the best evidence that we do have. For you, what is it that you think is the strongest photographic evidence that you've
seen? Well, I've used the Heflin photos, and I've used the McMinnville photos. I was just at the 15th annual McMinnville UFO conference on close to the anniversary of those pictures. I like those. I like, what's the guy's name? Salt Lake City, Utah photographer.
Oh, yeah, right. Yep.
And they're good. And what bothers me is that you'll get some of the debunkers saying, well, all you see is the lights in the sky in the pictures. And I don't use any pictures of lights in the sky. I use things, daytime photos. There's a place, Yugoslavian, not Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia, one of those countries. The picture looks like one of the other well-known pictures. And there are some decent pictures around. I like Trindade. I don't speak Portuguese, so Trinidadi it looks like, but I think it's Trindade, where the guy on board the ship took four pictures. It was there as part of the ship was there as part of the International Geophysical Year, and the pictures were released to the public. They were developed on board the ship. He was an official photographer, and they were released to the public by the president of Brazil, Juscelino Kubitschek. And of course, Donald Menzel said, "The photographer was known for making phony pictures." And sure, of course, he took in the president of Brazil, who had nothing to—he was having fun. I mean, it's ridiculous. But of course, then I found out that Dr. Menzel, unbeknownst to everybody in the field, including me, told Jack Kennedy that he had a longer continuous association with the National Security Agency of anybody in the country, 30 years as of 1960, he said, NSA and its Navy predecessors. And he was a cryptographer, all kinds of other things, which I discovered by going to the Harvard archives after getting permission from three different people. And there's another part of this thing, that the MJ-12 story. And sure, there are over 100 phony documents. So what? There are three genuine ones. That's good enough for me.
That's good enough for me, too. I'm going to take I have to do a quick station ID. This is KJCR, Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. We are speaking with Stanton T. Friedman. Okay, I just got that out of the way. I did want to visit MJ-12, and you and I were talking about that earlier today. And also, if you don't mind, I'm going to open up the phone lines because there are about probably 1,000 people that would like to call in and say, we're so happy to hear your voice. And I really do mean that. And earlier today, when I tweeted A couple of days ago, you and I were tweeting back and forth, and you were tweeting with all of the fader knots here on the show. Thank you for that. But I said, and I really meant this, I hope you didn't take it the wrong way. And I remember when I tweeted, I was like, he can't hear the tone of my voice, which was, you look great. Not meaning you didn't look good before. I did want to, but you looked great, and you had color in your face, and it didn't look like you just had a heart attack. So is that what happens when you get the stents put in, and maybe you were unhealthy before that and you're healthy now? You know what I mean? Is it like that?
Yeah, the strange thing, I had joined the gym about 6 months ago and was getting in shape. You know, I got all kinds of equipment that they didn't have when I was a kid. And weights were getting heavier and all that sort of thing.
Right, right.
And I had lost some weight and was in the best shape I'd been in for several years. And so when I was in the hospital, I wasn't sick. I had a heart attack. Okay, went to the hospital. I had to wait a few days before they could do the dye test and all that sort of stuff. But I wasn't bedridden. We have a very good cardiac unit in St. John, New Brunswick, which serves the whole province. And they turn out these dye tests 15 a day. I mean, if you're going to get something done, get it done by people who do lots of them, because they'll do it well, you know. And they found blockages. They put in the stents. I was not feeling sick. I was bored, frankly.
Did you ever panic? Like, oh, no, really?
What?
When he had the heart attack? I mean, did you panic, or did you drive yourself to the hospital?
No, I didn't. My daughter had just shown up. My wife couldn't drive because she'd had some eye surgery kind of stuff. But my daughter had just come. And I had the heart attack. I could feel the pain, and we put on the cuff to check the blood pressure. And one of the numbers went up over 200. And I said, we got to go to the hospital. And I was starting to sweat, and that was another indication that something was wrong. So I only live a mile and a half from the hospital. So my daughter took me and put me in a wheelchair, and we went inside. And they kept me for 3 days, and I went down to St. John. And like I say, I was bored. I didn't have time to really take a lot of stuff with me to read. You know?
I was so tempted to call you and send you an email. I wanted to see if I could get you on the air from the hospital. And I'm serious, too. You know, just what's going on.
Well, I had a phone put in, and you might have been able to do it.
I don't want to say next time, but.
Let's not.
Yeah, let's not. Let's not. Now, and again, I'm opening up the phone lines, 323-825-5045. Anybody would like to call in and say hi to Stan really quick. We'll do that before he leaves the air. With ufology is in flux right now, and I know you feel it. I know that you see it. I want to talk about the MJ-12 operations manual before you go. But before we do that, ufology is in a flux. And you are 80 years old.
Yep.
You've gone through a whole series of researchers through the 60s and 70s and 80s who are no longer with us. And now we've got a new wave coming in. I'm part of that. I'm enjoying it. Out of everybody that's out there right now, I'm not going to put words in your mouth or suggest anybody. But when you're looking at what's going on underneath you, because you're the king, you're at the top, you're looking down. Who do you respect today? Who is carrying that flag for us right now? Who do you respect?
Well, two people come to mind immediately. One is Dr. Bruce Maccabee, who's an optical physicist and has looked at more UFO pictures than anybody. Very sharp and gutsy guy. He published articles in scientific journals about the McMinnville photo, believe it or not, photos. Kathleen Marden, with whom I've written a couple of books, captured the Betty and Barney Hill UFO experience. She's Betty's niece.
Mm-hmm.
And our book, Science Was Wrong, which original title was supposed to be, It's Impossible, Isn't It?
Right, right.
publisher changed the title, but, and, you know, they have that right. I'm favorably impressed with Jan Harzen, who's the director of MUFON, for trying to get things back in order, so to speak. And there are other people who were working in the trenches, so to speak, who carry out all their assignments. There's CMS ratings in the MUFON journal, you know, and get everything assigned out. So those are the people who come to mind immediately. And I'm sure I'll have 27 people saying, why don't you talk about Joe, Bill, John, whatever. But, you know, it should be the work that matters, not so much the people. And I wasn't at the MUFON conference this year. I was supposed to be. I was supposed to speak there. But I read a couple of papers, as I recall. A couple of them were very good. They're not always good. And there are a lot of people, I get irked at ufology on occasion because this business of not having facts in hand before putting mouth in gear. My discoveries about Donald Menzel, whom I didn't like while he was alive, because I had one run-in with him, and it certainly didn't sound scientific to me. A Harvard University professor of astronomy.
Right.
And how could he be listed as part of this mysterious Majestic 12 group when everybody else clearly had a clearance just by their jobs? You know, the first three directors of Central Intelligence, Secretary of Defense, people like that, generals, admirals. But what's Menzel doing on there? You don't need a clearance to teach astronomy at Harvard. And I had one run-in with him when I was speaking at Harvard. I called to invite him to my lecture. Maybe you might say needled, but so I gave him my name. Oh, I know who you are. I know all about you. I said, oh, you read my congressional testimony next to yours? No, I've seen letters and memos. I just found out 2 weeks ago what that meant. Dr. Condon had sent copies of what I sent him to Menzel. I hadn't known that before.
It's a great story. I want you to continue with it, please. It's the thing is with Menzel, this is it. I want everybody to understand who we're talking about here in the short version. He was a member of MJ-12. He made the list. But yet, so if he's an insider with this and he's one of the sitting 12, publicly, he was anti-ET, anti-saucer, but yet...
Three books,
and he was a perfect guy. So if he's going to be disinfo on the outside, he would be the perfect guy for that, but yet he was part of MJ-12.
Well, people gave me a very hard time when I had to get permission from three different people to look at his papers at Harvard. I had to get permission to read his unpublished autobiography, at that time not available, and so forth. And I quoted from his letters to Jack Kennedy. Kennedy was on the Board of Overseers at Harvard, and his area of interest was astronomy, so he worked with Menzel. Menzel was on the Committee of Scientists to elect Kennedys in 1960. And one of the letters, for example, said, there's one area where I may be able to be of some help to you concerning the National Security Agency. I've had a longer continuous connection with them and their Navy predecessors of anybody in the country. And it turned out that Menzel had a loyalty hearing, which I'd never heard about. Nobody else had either that I knew about. 1,100 pages of testimony. And he said in his unpublished autobiography, it was the worst experience of his life. And so my findings about him, which convinced me that he was a member of MJ-12, that he did qualify, and that he had close connection with several other people that we didn't know about, made some people angry. He couldn't be. I wrote a paper, Double Life of Donald Menzel. And Stan, people can't lead double lives. That's nonsense. I said, look, here's three names for you, Burgess, Philby, and McLean. Three Russian spies working for British intelligence. Now, that's leading a double life. And the interesting thing, Sky and Telescope magazine had two issues devoted to Menzel, one when he died and one the 100th anniversary of his birth. And in neither one does it say anything about all the highly classified work he did after the war and that nobody knew about. He was a world-class cryptographer. He taught cryptography.
Yep.
At Radcliffe, Harvard Women's College. He did all did work for the CIA and for a whole bunch of companies. And yet they still didn't want to believe me, but none of them went to Harvard. You know, you're going to give me a hard time? Show me. I showed you. You know, and so I was shocked. I was not a fan of Menzel to begin with, as I said. And when I told him who I was and he said he knew all about me, memos and letters, his next line was a beaut. You can't be a scientist and believe in flying saucers.
Right.
And I laughed because I thought it was funny. And he started to rave and rant at me. And I said, look, Dr. Menzel, I didn't call to argue with you. I kept my cool. I said, I called out of courtesy. It's your campus. I don't know how much work they've done to publicize my program outside. It was an engineering alumni group. So I had no way of knowing that. And I just wanted to be polite. Oh, well, of course I won't go. So I told the story that night at the program so they know I wasn't afraid of him. But I was no friend of Don Menzel, that's for sure. So my findings came as a surprise to me. I found out lots of other stuff about MJ-12 and Menzel and so forth. But what irked me is that ufologists would express an opinion without doing their homework. And at least they approved of the fact that I proved that Phil Klass, which they already knew, I guess, did some, not nice things, irrational things, other things. The biggest debunker around after Menzel, Menzel died in the 70s, and I get a real laugh at my lectures when I show a copy of his check to me for $1,000.
I think he still owes me a grand.
Oh, really?
Hey, we have a quick phone call. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Stanton Friedman and Jimmy Church. Who's calling? You're live on the air with us.
Is this me right now?
Yes, it is you right now. Turn down your radio.
Oh, Jimmy, I'm so sorry. I'm in the car. It's Jonas from Long Island. How are you, sir?
Oh, hi. How are you, Jonas from Long Island?
Very good. Very good. Pleasure to be on. Mr. Friedman, it is an honor to talk to you, sir.
He just tweeted as he's driving on the Long Island Expressway listening to the show. So Jonas, what have you got real quick for Stanton?
If I could ask Mr. Friedman one question, it would be, what do you think is the biggest thing holding back the ufology movement from entering into mainstream media?
The fear of the main, it's not just the mainstream media, but the mainstream academic world. I can't tell you how many professors, well, they don't want to tell anybody that they're interested in this subject. They might lose tenure. It's fear, and, you know, they're stuck at the level of, if I say I'm interested in this, I will be ridiculed and so forth. And that's so ridiculous. You used to think that academia is the place where new ideas got examined, studied, reviewed, criticized. Instead, what we have is there's a knee-jerk reaction that this is all nonsense. Even though when I've been on campus, I often, incidentally, I get asked to speak to a colloquium or you know, meetings of the physics group or stuff in the afternoon and publicize my lecture that evening. And I've been told by students that Dr. So-and-so is ready to show that you're some kind of a nut. So I take this as an interesting challenge, and I go to the board and talk about some things I know they don't know anything about, the electromagnetic submarine, the nuclear rocket, things like that. And then I'll ask them, what's the numerical value of 1G acceleration? 9.8 meters per second squared. Everybody knows that. I said, well, okay, how do you relate that to a Corvette? and they look at me like I'm talking Swahili. I said, well, 1G is 21 miles per hour per second. So if you accelerate a car at 1G, at the end of 3 seconds, it's going 63 miles an hour. That's a pretty hot car because most cars take 4, 5, 6 seconds. Then I say, okay, what's the speed of light? What numerical value? 300,000 kilometers per second. I say, okay, give me that in units that mean something to anybody. They look at me again. I say 670 million miles an hour. But the real question is, how long does it take at 1G to get to the speed of light? It's a multiple choice question. 1,000 years, 100 years, 10 years, 1 year. How many think it's 1,000? Then how many think it's 100?
Right. Can I guess? Hold on. Can I guess?
Sure.
1 year.
That's right.
Yeah, I feel good.
One year.
Let's grab it.
But these are professors who think that it takes 1,000 years, for God's sake.
You know? Let's grab another call. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Stanton Friedman and Jimmy Church. Who's calling?
This is Bear.
Hi, Bear. How are you tonight? Where are you calling from?
Santa Clara, California.
Right on, Bear. Right on. What have you got tonight for Stanton?
I'm at Stanton at the Santa Clara Convention Center many, many years ago with George. And I heard you talking about speed of light. And believe it or not, that's a variable.
Okay, Bear. Okay. What have you got for Stanton? You got a question?
I just wanted to say hello and say I'm glad that he made it through everything okay. And if you want to verify that equation, it's coupling's constant, and that it is a variable, and it depends on the wavelength of light.
Well, we know that the speed of light varies with the index of refraction of the medium. So, yeah, it's true. But the question is whether you don't need to go faster than the speed of light, because people want half an Einstein. They want to forget the fact that Einstein also said that as you get closer to the speed of light, time slows down, depending on how close you get it. 99.99% of the speed of light, you can go 37 light years in 6 months, pilot time. You go out, come back, marry your granddaughter's best friend, and... life goes on, and
hey, Jimmy.
Yes, sir.
One other thing, you know, you've been spraying your chair with WD-40.
Yep.
And that's not a real good lubricant. Oh. That's more of a rust preserver. You know.
What do you think I should use, Bear?
Graphite. Okay. And possibly some liquid wrench.
Yeah, because.
And if you can, get some lube oil, like you lube your front end of your car with,
yep.
Maybe.
Okay.
Okay, try that and see how that works out. But I think what you'll find is WD-40 will turn to gel, and it's more of a, to preserve your tools from getting rusty.
Thank you, Bear. I'll tell Stanton what we're talking about here in just a second.
Okay.
Thank you, Bear. Okay. You have a good night.
No problem.
Yes. Stanton, in the last 3 months, I've gone through 3 chairs here in the studio. They eventually start squeaking, and you can hear it. So I sprayed everything with WD-40 like 2-3 weeks ago, and finally it's gone away. In the last 2 or 3 shows, hear that? It's back. Oh, so funny. And let me ask you, every time I talk about the speed of light on this show, I get the emails the next day and we all went through nothing is faster than the speed of light. We went through that period. Now there's a possibility that that it is possible to go faster than the speed of light. Okay, let's just stay with that statement for a second. If something goes faster, what are we talking about here that would be what would be going faster than the speed of light? Are we referring to possibly a starship, or are we talking atoms? Are we talking radio waves? What is it that would travel faster than the speed of light? A physical object of some kind, or us?
Well, I think, as I suggested a minute ago, that the physical objects can travel. It depends on the frame of reference. That's where the difference comes in. You know, are you talking about the places that are out there or the place where you are when you're going between here and there? And there are a couple of things that happen when you get close to the speed of light. Mass increases. That doesn't hurt you too much if your particles in a fusion propulsion system are produced with enormous energy. You're not accelerating them to enormous energy. People neglect that little detail when they tell you that, oh, the mass increases. And whose frame of reference are you talking about? It's already up there, so to speak. There is a lot of good work done that shows that you can get here from there or there from here using, say, fusion propulsion system. I worked on a study of that in 1962. Boy, that makes me feel old. For Aerojet, as a matter of fact. With a guy who was head of the Oak Ridge National Laboratory fusion program, incidentally, Dr. John Luce. This wasn't a dink that swept the floor.
Right.
And so there's plenty of work out there. In my book, Flying Saucers and Science, I have a chapter, You Can Get Here From There, in which I go over some of this stuff. And, you know, the people who say you can't won't do their homework, which isn't surprising, but that's the way it is. Incidentally, my website, we haven't mentioned, www.stantonfriedman.com, and books you get from me have my signature on
them. Hey, by the way, the new website looks great. When did you put it up?
Well, I didn't. My webmaster did. I don't do that sort of stuff. I got a good guy who does that. And not that long ago, he's a good guy. And like I say, I'm not a big computer guy, and that surprised a lot of people, I must say. They said, geez, Dan, I thought you'd be hot for all the computers. I said, look, I was using computers sort of in the late 50s, but I filled out input data sheets. A girl typed them, made cards, key punched them, and took a box of those cards and a big reel of tape up to the computer, which was a mile away, and which none of the engineers and scientists could get near. And she'd come back with a pile of output. We didn't touch any hardware.
Never.
And I knew there was a problem when I got my first computer and I was talking to my daughter and stuff, and she came back and she'd been in the other room, and what'd you do? I said, well, I turned it off. How'd you do that? I pushed that. That's not how you turn it off. How do you turn it off? You push the start button, Dad. I knew I was in trouble.
Another call from Star 6. Star 6, how are you tonight, sir? You're live with Stanton Friedman. Star 6, are you there? See, he's listening to his radio. He's on a delay. And he doesn't realize that he's now live on the air. Star 6, one last shot. Okay. All right. You know, there's nothing worse in radio than dead air, Stanton. That's what they say.
Yeah, I know.
Hey, okay. Now, really, let's change gears. I can't really say how, what, when, and where, but I have been talking this week off of the air about the MJ-12 operations manual, about the retrieval of, I forget how it is phrased in the manual, but let's just say ET craft.
Yeah.
Now, okay, well, here's Star 6. Let's grab Star 6 really quick. Star 6, you're live with Stanton Friedman.
Oh, I'll try it again. I got the right button. Hey, I'm with you, Stan. I can't stand these computers. Anyhow. I am so alive tonight. You know, Stan, I got to tell you, when you're talking about this subject, and by the way, excuse me just for a moment, and of course, Mr. Jimmy knows I'm this way. I didn't know what the subject was until I listened to you, and boy, did you hit a note with me tonight, and that is the speed of sound, I mean the speed of light. In just a second, I'll touch it, but the same thing that just makes me vibrate is the same thing that you're really talking about. Meaning, is there anything faster than the speed of light? My contention is, and I call it the limbata. I call it the limbata of the ions. I believe that is the secret because, in case you didn't notice, I kind of got a weird name, Star 6. I come from Star 6. The only way I can get here is doing the limbata. What do you think?
But like a limbo dancing? I
mean, well, it's when the ions just all of a sudden just decide to vibrate.
Interesting. Thank you.
I don't know how to do that.
Thank you.
Well, it's in the subatomic level, and it's quantum, it's Tesla, it's everything wrapped into one thing. My old man, he told me about it, but I'm 70 years old now, and I don't remember too well. Besides that, he's on Star 6. He doesn't tell me anything anymore. Good night, Jimmy.
Good night, Star 6. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome, sir.
And what he's referring to there, Stanton, is vibration in between universes, and possibly that is how when we're looking at an ET craft, you know, something's up there, and then boom, it's gone. You know, you photograph something, you know, it's zipped in and zipped out of what we know now.
You do that electromagnetically.
Sure.
We have systems magnetoforming. You slam a hunk of metal into a die to get a peculiar shape. And you better not slam for very long, very tiny. It's like with lasers, you know, there goes an eyeball if you keep it up too long. You know?
Right, right. And... do you think
go on.
Well, do you think that that is an explanation or a partial explanation for, you know, why something isn't seen for minutes or hours, that it just comes and goes and quite possibly might even be accidental?
The kicker here is that when you look at data and how much acceleration people can stand, us Earthlings, a trained pilot can perform a tracking task while being accelerated at 14 Gs for 2 minutes. That's an acceleration at 300 miles per hour per second. Per second. That's measured data. We need to know how much pilots can stand. It also turns out that you can stand 30 Gs for 1 second. You say, big deal. Well, that's 0 to 600 miles an hour in 1 second. So that's here and then not here. Think about that for a minute. In other words, when you hear reports of high maneuverability UFOs, they're going rapidly. They make a right angle turn, and they're going rapidly. They're not slowing down and then speeding up after they make the turn. And the way to do that is magneto-aerodynamically. Exert a large force in a short period of time. And also, we need to stress to people that we're dealing with two parts of the system, one between the stars, say a fusion propulsion system. Fusion is what produces almost all the energy in the universe, in all the stars. And the other, when you get here, magneto-aerodynamic system. In the atmosphere, they're two drastically different environments. And we have people are shocked by this, but we have nuclear-powered aircraft carriers that can operate for 18 years without refueling. They carry about 90 small airplanes that can operate for less than 2 hours without refueling. In different environments, different techniques, makes sense. We do it all the time. So when people say, couldn't have crashed, a starship couldn't crash at Roswell. And I say, I didn't say it did. I say it's an Earth excursion module that was brought here by a mothership, if you want to call it that, the nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, so to speak, space carrier. So we got to do some thinking about these things, and some of the debunkers just don't think about these things. It's unfortunate, but, you know, that's the way it is.
Let's try to get to this manual. Let's do this. And thank you for hanging on for a little longer tonight. It is so late out there. And again, thank you very much. I have my own opinions why I think the manual is real. The verbiage is one thing. That's not why I think it's real. I think it's real because it's too. It would have been too difficult and too expensive to graphically produce back then. Typesetting and photography and labs and binding and all of it. It's not today's world where everything is computerized and electronic. There's a whole nother set of efforts that had to go into produce that manual then. But for you, what is it? You told me today, and I think you said this to me before, actually, that you're 95% on it. I'm 100%. For you, it's 95. Why is it 95% authentic?
Because I haven't spent enough time to fill in that other 5%. I'd give you 99 plus on the Eisenhower briefing document, on the Truman Forrestal memo, and the Cutler Twining memo, because I've looked at those rather exhaustively. They're much shorter, incidentally, than the manual. And so I leave room for the manual to be genuine. And Bob Wood has done some fine work on the typefaces and all that stuff. But three is enough. You know, if the Eisenhower briefing document is genuine, then case closed. I do get a big kick out of from audiences when I show Phil Klass's check to me for $1,000 for proving him wrong about the Cutler Twining memo. Here's a guy who never went to the Eisenhower Library, but he was trying to say that all their documents are done in elite type, and that the Pica type on this one proves that it's a fraud, the Cutler Twining memo. He's never been to the Eisenhower Library. He offered me $100 each for a genuine memo, meeting a bunch of requirements, done in the same size and style type, up to a maximum of 10, unfortunately. So I was going to the Eisenhower Library, and I grabbed 14. It's easy to tell the difference between the big Pica and the small elite. And sent him copies and an invoice, and he paid me my $1,000. 10 was the maximum. And then he got very angry when I showed a copy of his check and something I wrote, threatened to sue me. So I told him, Phil, you sent me a check. I Xeroxed it. I took the check to the bank. They cashed it. I can do whatever I darn please with the Xerox. And he shut up, which is rare for him. But it's typical of the intellectual bankruptcy of the pseudoscience of anti-ufology. You make a claim, don't worry about the facts, the data, make it sound good. And that was typical.
Well, it's easy to be a skeptic when it comes to ufology. That's the easy, if I was going to have a gig, if I was going to have a, that would be the, well, no. That's all. That's it. Well, no. That's the argument. That's their stance. No. And
anything but alien.
Yeah,
ABA.
Anything but alien. When you have, you know, hundreds of thousands of sightings and evidence and photographs and video crashes and eyewitness testimony and radar evidence and tapes, you have all of that on that side of the fence. All they have to say is, well, no. No, that's it. No. So,
well, a good example with Klass, he was on Larry King with David Jacobs, and he started off by saying, well, all those people in David's book about abductions had mental health problems. Now, Klass is an electrical engineer, and the foreword to the book was written by a Harvard psychiatrist, but we don't count about that. But later on in the show, Larry cleverly asked Phil if he'd read the book. No. And the same thing happened about Roswell. He had Kevin Randall on, and Phil was ranting at the beginning, and then later on Larry asked him if he'd read the book. No. You know, I'm glad that once in a while some newsman does something that exposes the idiocy for what it is. And it's not just the $1,000 that he paid me, but that's so typical of the irrationality of the arguments and the solutions to how could this be? Oh, well, and he comes up with an explanation that makes no sense. And at one point he said these were plasmas that people were seeing. Jim McDonald published a paper in which he showed Phil didn't know a darn thing about plasmas. you know, not surprising.
I would love. I wish he was still alive. I would love to have him on this show. And I mean, seriously. And there was a certain amount of condescending arrogance about him that for me, it would just be fun just to ruffle him. It would be sport. And it's too bad he's not around. Look, God rest his soul. I'm not saying. But when you look at those old videos and the interviews, just the arrogance about them would just make my blood boil. And so there you go. Stanton, thank you. Thank you for staying up so late with us tonight. And
I don't want my blood to boil.
Yeah, I don't want
to
be
that. Thank you for having me.
All the best. We'll bring you back, and we've got so much more always to talk about. Thank you, Stanton, and you have a great night.
Thanks. Good night.
Good night. Stanton Friedman, everybody, thank you. Kept him up way past his bedtime. I'm looking at Rick Sennett's tweet here. He's from where? He just settled with the IRS, Mr. Tucker, by the way. All right. Oh, man. Okay, I'm going to open up the phone lines. I want to talk to everybody about what happened last night too as well, and I want to hear from everybody about that last night. Okay, the Area 51 caller, Brian Glass. Okay, so with that, let's take a quick. I need a breather, and thank you, Stanton Friedman, for that. Thank you for all the calls that came in. I'm opening up the phone lines right now. 323-825-5045. We got a few minutes left. Let's bang some calls right here on Fade to Black. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Hi, everybody. This is Rob Halford, the Metal God, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? My name's Brian Taylor, Ninja Badass Extraordinaire, and this is JimmyChurchRadio.com.
KJCR in your face.
JimmyChurchRadio.com
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right, welcome back. Stanton Friedman, nice and healthy. Sounds good, doesn't he? This is Fade to Black only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Thank you, Stanton. Stayed up really late past his bedtime. And he told me earlier tonight, Jimmy, man, I just had a heart attack. You know, go easy on me tonight. I said, Stan, it'll be good. Don't worry about it. Okay, man, let's do this. So thank you, Stanton. All right, first call. You're live on Fade to Black. Who's calling? Where are you calling from?
It's Rick. I'm calling from Vegas. How's it going?
How you doing tonight, Rick?
My night is good. My day, not so much.
Why?
Just work stuff.
I saw you tweet earlier today that you destroyed a mouse.
yeah, first time in my life I've ever done that. I had a little bit of a nerd rage fit.
Well, I'm going to throw some questions out at you, but you called first. You're the first caller after Stanton. So what's on your mind?
One of the things I wanted to ask him, especially since he's Canadian, unless I'm mistaken, is why is everybody focusing on the United States to do disclosure?
You know, I was going to...
isn't that kind of arrogant?
Yes.
Or something, you know?
Yes, it is. And we are self-centered here. There's no doubt about that. I was going
to
ask...
Well, it's the entire world. I mean, yes. Other countries are looking at the United States to do disclosure. But we're not the only people in the world that have had UFOs. I mean... Rendlesham, you know, Brazil.
Yeah, Costa Rica, Peru, Chile, Argentina. All over Europe. There's no question. Yeah. There's no question about that.
And like I just tweeted to Lynn, all it takes is one country to say, you know, up yours. We're tired of your shenanigans. We're gonna spill the beans.
Yes, yes. And so, why would it be? Why would it be us? And it seems like the feeling, and maybe it's because we live here, but that we expect, you know, it's going to be over New York City, or the arrival's going to be on the White House lawn, or, you know, over Los Angeles.
I get that. A lot of that has to do with the media. Why do we expect it to be here? Why wouldn't it be over Paris, or why wouldn't it happen in Moscow or Rome or Egypt and Giza, for that matter?
Or South Africa.
Yes.
I mean, remember District 9?
Yes. Actually, a pretty cool movie. Pretty cool movie. Yeah. I don't get that, but let's not lose sight of one thing, though. Whenever somebody needs help out there, you know, it's us that they turn to for help, whether it's with the military, whether it's financial aid, whether it is food and resources. We are always there first. I don't want to piss off a bunch of people by saying that, but it certainly seems.
We tend to be the first in.
It seems like we have the checkbooks out first, and whenever somebody, I have no idea, I really don't. But how many countries in the world right now just get a check every single year from the United States? Just a check. I have no idea, but I'm sure it's an extraordinary amount of money. I don't know.
In fact, you know, MG just said, as a Canadian, I'm looking at disclosure as a global thing, and I completely agree with her on that. It really should be a global thing.
Well,
think actually how it'll end up coming out is there will be a big reveal, and look at that. Hey, you know, there are aliens, and everybody's going, well, hey, what about Roswell? Oh, well, that's classified. But hey, look, they're here now.
Right.
I actually think that's how it's going to happen.
Well, look what the French and the British and Argentina and Chile and Brazil, Mexico, I think all of those countries right now are, if they haven't, certainly they are ready to absolutely step forward, and they are not, because we're not letting them, and until we do it, everybody else is kind of holding back. But I totally think all of South America, Central America, Europe, the French and the Belgians and the United Kingdom, with everything that they put forward, I think they're ready to go, you know. But why not? What is holding them back? I mean, Costa Rica, that photograph that was taken of the survey plane over Costa Rica when they were doing the mapping, and that disc just pops up in the photograph. What can you say at that point? You can't say they don't exist when it's clearly in a government photograph that they released.
Well, you know my answer. Swamp gas.
What's that?
Swamp gas. that's my answer for everything. That's the anti-sucralose answer, is swamp gas.
So what? Oh man, I'm still waiting. You know, I've been waiting. I haven't seen my first swamp gas yet. You know what's funny is, look up. Have you ever done a Google search for images of swamp gas? Have you ever done that?
Yeah, remember? That's how you got that.
Oh, yeah. You sent me the whole internet. There's only like two.
Yeah, exactly.
That's it.
And those are two pictures of the same example.
Yes, that's it. Try
pulling up ball lightning.
Oh, that's also intriguing. Well, you know, with ball lightning, one of the more fascinating aspects of ball lightning is look at some of the historical representations of ball lightning, and I'm referring to the Middle Ages engravings, paintings that were done on it back then. That's pretty bizarre to me. They were seeing something. I've never seen ball lightning. We've all seen lightning a million times. I've never seen ball lightning. But to see it represented what they were seeing back in the Middle Ages, and look at some of these engravings and paintings of they didn't call it ball lightning, but there was something that was ball lightning-ish flying around back then. I find that very intriguing. And why hasn't
the German woodcut with all the discs and the arrows and all that. I mean,
over Nuremberg.
Yeah, Nuremberg. You know the woodcut I'm talking about.
Oh yeah, there's actually two. They're 5 years apart. I think 5 years. Don't anybody bust my chops, Eugene. But Rick, what did you think about last night?
I had my 13-year-old listening with me, and we're sitting there, and we just hear the guy going off the rails, and I'm looking over my kid. His eyes are wide. I mean, just with this, what the heck am I listening to? Kind of smile on his face. You know, that kind of like, wow, this guy's flipping out. And we're just kind of laughing, thinking, okay, this dude's off his meds. And I was listening to some of it, and I'm thinking, oh, it's some guy calling in trying to recreate the Area 51 call. That was my first reaction.
And what was your second reaction?
My second reaction when it came out is just kind of like chuckling with my typical "I'll be damned" type of response. Like, you know, that's funny.
And after that, I want your thoughts. After that, when you found out that finally, after 17 years, here we have the identity of the Area 51 caller. Were you cleansed? Did you feel better?
You know, I was not as emotionally invested in it as some of the other Fader Knots.
Right.
And some of Art Bell's listeners, especially for the ones that were following when that happened. So for me, it's kind of like finding out if you pulled a prank.
Exactly.
Because initially, yeah, when I initially heard it, I wasn't really buying it. You know, I mean, it was freaky, but
right.
You know me, I'm not as entrenched with some of the beliefs out there. I mean, as Lou says, you know, with Rick, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar.
Right.
You know, and I also believe that, you know, stuff happens. So with the satellite, I really don't know. I mean, I really don't know if there's some guy with a finger on the kill button for a satellite, if somebody gets out of hand with information on the radio or whatever it gets. I mean, especially with things in this genre, you know, the fringe, it's easily discounted. I mean, regardless of how much evidence you produce or how many, you know, coincidences, they're just too good to be a coincidence.
What were the odds? You know, what were the odds of that happening? Let's, you know what? Stay on the line with us, Rick. Let's grab another call. I just dropped like three in a row. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Jimmy Church.
Hey, Jimmy, how you doing?
Who's calling?
This is Bear again from Santa Clara.
Hey, Bear, what's going on?
Oh, not much, but I got an explanation for swamp gas for you.
Okay, real quick, what is it?
Well, it's when a bear is out in the swamp and he lets one go and lightning hits it.
Thank you, Bear.
And then I heard the one last night, I heard on Art Bell quite a while back. And I was wondering what in the heck happened. That's pretty crazy scenario there.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, anyway.
Yeah, thank you, Bear. And he brings up a great point. For everybody out there, that's why I did what I did when I did it, which is we're talking about 17 years has gone by. And that mystery about that needed to be, and I was in the position to, you know, put it out there for everybody. So the you know, and I didn't want to offend, I didn't want to freak out, but the purpose of this show is to learn, and that is something that has been out there for a long, long time, and I think it was very important to finally put it to bed and allow Brian Glass to finally have a platform where he could go and explain what happened. The shocking thing for me, Rick, was when Brian had said this, that it was all fun. It was supposed to be just a fun night. It wasn't his fault that the satellite went down. It wasn't Art's fault. I mean, if the call would have been completed like it was how it was intended, you know, in the end, hey, you know, Art, this was just a dramatic, theatrical presentation. Thank you. Click, and hung up the phone. Then it's all, you know, it's fun. But, you know, poor Brian, you know, and then for the satellite to go down like it did and everything happened like it did, and then he had to write on it for 17 years, and he didn't have to. This is the thing, and I want your opinion on this. He didn't have to come on the air. He's a successful writer. He does great. There's no reason to come on the air. Nobody knows, you know, there's nothing to gain. You know, he could have just left it silent and lived on with his life knowing that he was the caller. But there's no reason to, you know, put himself in that position. And he did that last night for everybody. And I think it was very important to do.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was good to clear the air for all the people. Well, like I said before, that were emotionally invested into it.
Right.
And also, I mean, depending on how he felt about it, most people, possibly even including myself, after trying to reach out to Art and explain, hey, you know, sorry, it's supposed to be a piece of theater. Things went wrong. About that.
And not only that, think about how many thousands of people were claiming to be that guy.
Yeah, exactly. And I think after I tried to explain and apologize, I would probably just leave it be and just be like, oh, well, you know, it happens.
We just grabbed another call. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Jimmy Church. Who's calling? Where are you calling from?
Hello, Mr. Church.
Gene.
Arkansas.
Gene.
How are you, Gene?
I just want to say that last night and tonight, you sure got it cracking.
Thank you, Gene. All the best, man, and thank you for everything that you do for the show, man.
Yes, sir, brother. And all you fader nuts, sleep light and keep your eyes open because the sandbox is scary.
Gene V. Thank you, all right, Gene. Brother. All the best, my brother.
Brother, good night.
Good night.
Great, man.
Hey, did you hear Gene's spot that he did? I've got like, it's funny. I'm trying to, there's six calls backed up here, and we're at the end of the night. I won't be able to get to everybody. I apologize for that. Did you hear Gene's drop that he did for the station?
Oh, yeah. It was great.
Amazing. That was awesome. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. It was, I equate it to not only what Gene did, but what all the Fader Knots have done, all of the artwork and the community that we have built here, and certainly, Rick, you're part of that. But putting that Fader Knot page together and looking at that and looking at everybody's artwork, it puts a lump in my throat. I mean, it's overwhelming.
In fact, even my kids got a picture for you.
Shut up. Are you serious?
Yeah. Yeah, he's got a picture for him.
And when am I going to see it?
As soon as I get it scanned, and as soon as he gives me the okay that it's cleaned up.
I can't wait, man! Yeah. I cannot wait. You've got to get.
Yeah, he's taking Rita's advice and just drawing everything that he sees.
Oh, fantastic, man. Your family is great. And I had an amazing time hanging out with you guys. And what more can I say? You've got an amazing family. So
they get on my nerves once in a while, but.
stop. It's called being a family, my brother. It's called being a family. So anyway, thanks. We're back up against it tonight, Rick. So. I'm going to boogie and say thank you for that. And again, really quick, just say, Stanton, it was great to have you back tonight. Say that for Stanton really quick.
Stanton, thank you for everything. And we are all glad that you're back.
So great to hear his voice, wasn't it?
Oh yeah. Yeah, it was. He's the Jimi Hendrix of ufology.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. No doubt. Yeah. No doubt. No doubt about it. And for him, and when you go back and how long he has been doing this,
And he has seen so many people come and go, a lot of them go. I mean, he's 80 years old now, you know, to see
everybody. He doesn't sound it.
No, he doesn't. And I mentioned to him earlier today about Eric Von Daniken and how Eric and I were talking about him. You know, the both of them are the same age. And
oh, wow.
It's amazing to just hear man, how do I want to say this in the right way? That it's still there. Nothing has gone away. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, what do they say?
The fire is still there.
What do they say? First the body, then the mind? Or is it the mind, then the body? How does that go?
I'm not sure. It depends on your genetics.
Oh, Rick Sennett. Thank you, my brother. All the best. Give my best to the family. And
Definitely. And
I'll see you tomorrow night for the big fader night.
Cool, man. Take it easy.
All the best.
Okay.
Thanks, Rick. Oop. Sorry about that. That's what you know. That's what you call a mouse click at the wrong time. Oh, I just have to say, what an overwhelming night tonight. Thank you for everybody that called in. Twitter, Tweet Deck. Twitter without Tweet Deck is almost worthless. And I will get Tweet Deck fixed tomorrow. Twitter without Tweet Deck, it doesn't even make sense to me. It's too much work. Oh, check that out. That is really cool. Lifetime Achievement Award to Stanton Friedman. And that's from Dale. Dale, thank you. Thank you for that. Stanton Friedman, I will. Did you copy, by the way? Did you copy? Hey, Dale, you've got to go back and copy, send this over to Stanton. And his actual Twitter feed is in the system here. So all you have to do is go back. But he would love to see this. Pretty cool. And Fady. Fady is right there. I didn't get to email tonight. I apologize for that. It was a rockin' evening. I'm going down. I'm looking at all of this. I apologize to everybody, but it was just an action-packed night. Also, I've got to thank Phil Hendrie for coming on the show with us tonight, too, as well. All right, so with that, let's go ahead and bust it and get out of here. Tomorrow night, don't forget, is Fader Night. My favorite night of them all. Thank you to Stanton T. Friedman. Thank you to Phil Hendrie. Thank you to all of the callers tonight. Everybody that is still waiting on hold, I apologize. There's just not enough time to get everybody in. Stay tuned. Coming up next. What is coming up next? I don't know. I didn't put it in my notes. Special thanks to Keith Rowland and Art Bell. Fade to Black's executive producer. I'm looking here. Keith didn't send me who's coming up next. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Kamarian. Show is produced by Hilton J. Palm and Mark D. Kovar. The announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vateau, and Mark D. Kovar. Music is by Doug Aldrich. Show intros produced by or performed by Spaceboy. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your humble host, Jimmy Church. We will see all of you here, all of you, tomorrow night on Fader Night. I'm out of here. I'm watching all these calls. I'm sorry I couldn't get to them. Call in tomorrow night. I'll see ya. La 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 la